长、各位来宾、各位、同事、老师、大家好。今天很高兴啊，这个我们有几位国外的这个贵宾啊，这都是各方面的专家来这个参加我们这个会议跟大会啊。那首先我们请校长先给我们支持一下，谢谢。
大家早哈，我想 Eden 对象都，这是 International Conference 啊，但是我想 Eden 都我们都讲中文啊，所以我就，那是他们的那个 PowerPoint 是英文啊，所以我们趁这个机会可以写点英文啊。那今天很高兴我们请到那个三位非常杰出的那个四位啊，海外就是三位，那我们国内我们就请那个张副院长，当然那个吴教授也在嘛哈。教授也是，他是我们这个本校的老师哈，来参加这个就是今年这个Big Data 跟那个 Bioinformatics Conference 啊。那我们知道这是一个Big Data 的时代了哈。那个阿里巴巴认为他的公司不是那个 IT company， 他认为是他是 Data Technology company 这样子，所以可见那个 Data 非常重要，这样非常重要啊。那我们知道。我们面临很多问题啊，比如说那个最近那个 California 那个恐攻啊，跨国啊，这个 terrorist 啊，然后其实面临很多各种challenge， 包括这个在跨国现在那个 climate 上面，就是气候一个峰会啊，还有很多天然灾害。现在还包括前一阵子那个就是日本福岛的那个这个核能厂天然的灾害啊，所以我们很多人类面临的问题像这个天然的灾害啊，水还有粮食的问题环境污染的问题还有这个一些目前很多一些恐怖分子的那个还有这个网络的 virus， 然后我们是生活在一个就是一个 cyber space 一个网络的时代每天都在各位大概每天你到任何地方你不能少的就是手机嘛你这个所有东西都在手机都在check 你的就是所有东西在云端那都是 big data， 所以我想这都是 big data 潜在的一个应用包括在不管在那个 marketing 这个消费者那个心理的预测，还有就是很多那个公司的营运产业的未来还有包括像制造业，台中就是制造业的基地我想说制造业这一块，还有观光等等很多的应用。那我们学校跟中国医药大学是姐妹兄弟学校所以我们的中亚人大，那中医大它有十几个医院，那亚大。目前我们在盖医院，今年就开始营业所以我们把那个medical 这一块变成我们一个学校的一个重点然后有 bioinformatics 生物系，我们大概十几年前创校的时候就成立了这样子，所以我们是有很多同仁还有我们的同学在做这个生物资讯上的研究，主要是 medical 的这些所以我们现在几个重点，其他几个重点大概一个 big data， 一个就是物联网。一个是3D打印，陈立燕跟 Georgia Tech 那个，我是林六在这边，他是 Georgia Tech 的跟中大有个 3D 很紧的一个 center 这样子另外就是目前这个 Cloud Computing， 还有就是我们在发展这个 Smart 那个 Campus 这是我们学校的一个重点那我们现在实际上是有个 group 跟那个我们张副院长。帮忙，因为他们这个还是要domain的 expertise 要帮忙做所以我们现在是有定级的一个预测机构在做那个精准医疗奥巴马几年前就提出的美国那个 precision medicine 这是一个重点我们知道那个 big data 它有至少有四个那个 不一致，大家都知道那个 volume 或者是velocity 啊，还有那个它那个 variety 有多样性，还有它那个 veracity 就是资料的真实性啊。那特别在这个多样性，还有这个啊，还有这个真实性啊，我想是特别的挑战，因为很多的 data 都非常 messy， 都是 unstructured 啊，如何来针对这些这个大量啊，而且 unstructured data 来process， 能够从中间能够得到重要的一些 knowledge， 我想这是目前发展的重点。所以我们现在重点是在这个精神医疗啊，从金融啊，从这个很多那个 omics 的 data， 还有就是环境，还有那个 lifestyle 等等啊，一些能够能够做更精准的那个diagnosis， 那个 prevention 还有 treatment， 这是我们其他一个努力的方向。所以我们特别邀请这个三个国外都非常杰出的那个演讲者，包括 Professor Lin Liu， 他是非常杰出，做在 database 跟 big data 已经十几年，他目前是 HV transaction 那个 service computing 的总编辑这样子。然后我们那个还有那个博威斯徐六，他也是系主任啊，他是系主任在 Missouri， 我们跟 Missouri 有那个签了 MOU 了啊，阿联是台中，所以我们都可以联络合作。他现在当系主任，而且那个他一个 Biomedical Institute 的 Director 是不是啊？阿博士 Chen， 他也是台中的媳妇，是不是？啊，他也非常杰出，他也先 run 一个那个 Asia Pacific 的 Biomedical Conference， 非常好一个。Teachers Conference， 他是主要那个这个 Conference 的创始人，而且乱这个 Conference 已经十几年了这样子啊，所以他是目前当系主任，在那个 Australia 那个 La Trobe 啊 ，La Trobe 那个当系主任，所以他们都非常非常杰出。那我们希望透过这个研讨会，我们可以跟这些杰出的学者能够多合作啊，因为国际化是我们学校的一个目标，我们希望跟国际的学者能够在研究上啊，能够多合作，所以我们希望透过这个今天大概明天两天哈，所以今天我们有整天的那个 talk， 还有一个 panel， 那明天我们会向内容的同仁，我们会报告目前来做的一些东西，希望能够有一些交集。那明天下午我们会那个参观那个中国医药大学，中国大学现在是在上海交大的 ranking， 它是在 CRIT。那个临床医学上，它是前亚洲第七名，好像前亚洲第七名，在台湾是超过台大跟长荣这样子啊。那他们在上海交大，还有 Times， 还有很多的 ranking 都是全世界百大的学校。他们做的实际上是这个这几年对不对，做的非常好这样子。所以我们希望透过这个参观，能够多了解中国医药大学的一些目前的一些研究的能量，能够多合作。然后今天下午有一个 tour， 就是这个美术馆啊，这个是一个世界级的美术馆，这个是由日本的安藤忠雄那个先生设计的啊，他是那个就是 Pritzker Award， 就是建筑界的诺贝尔得主啊，这是前台湾的他的唯一的建筑，也是前世界大学校园第一件，这是世界级的一个建筑。那目前已经很多展览，大家我想那个。有些人已经看过，像波先天六上次大家也看过，上次在展那个豆荚，我们展过Modern and More 等等，目前是展那个青春无限啊，青春无限是四个那个就是两个是台湾，一个是中国大陆啊，一个是日本的一个艺术家啊，我想这个也欢迎各位能够来参观这个美术馆，我们这个展览事实上都是世界级的这样子啊。那今天很谢谢那个张院长，还有我们这个三个。非常珍贵性的这个海外的一些研究者，事实上我们都好朋友，已经好几年了，他们都做得非常杰出啊，所以希望能够通过这个机会互相交流，跟我们的老师跟我们的同学啊，那祝这个研讨会成功啊，祝各位身体健康，记得微笑，
谢谢各位。
这个校长这个不仅是一个开场啊，他对这个。整个 program 的这个 schedule 哈，以及这个领域的这个发展都做了很精辟而广泛的这个介绍。那我最近有跟那个澳门大学的 Lino 也会交换这个 email。 我跟他说我来到亚大最高兴，就是说我到这里只是三个多月，但是我碰到了一些研究的这个杰出的学者以及好朋友，已经很多很多人了。那今天我又碰到三位这个好朋友这边来哈。所以我们第一位是先请这个张建国副院长来跟我们做这个keynote speech 哈，但是 Big Data in Hospital。 那张副院长呢，他是我看他的资料是从1993年就开始，就一直得到这个国科会哈，现在科技部的这个杰出的研究奖哈。那他目前是在中国医药大学的医学院担任副院长，同时也是在医院里面当这个副院长，所以他是这个两方面都实务跟这个这个比较学理上面都很精辟哈。那他现在就是刚刚校长也有提到啊，就是这个一个普及群啊 medicine 啊，希望能够提那个科技部的失效应用计划啊。那张副院长一直都在担任我们的这个顾问啊，一直给我们一直指导啊。那我们欢迎他。
蔡校长，还有三位那个著名的学者哈，还有各位老师、各位同学，那今天我很荣幸的能跟各位介绍一下，就关于 Big Data 在 Hospital 的情形。那我们知道，我们人哈要表现型哈，它是决定这个表现型的因素是从金融还有 epigenome。那这金融跟 epigenome 受到 environmental factor 哈，那包括那个 physical chemical factor， 还有 lifestyle， 还有 behavior， 还有用状了以后哈，就会产生一个 phenol。那这个 phenol 又产这个 phenotype， 那产就跟你的 human 决定你的 human activity 的表现型，然后在这个过程就会产生一大堆的 big data 哈。那所有的病，就医院来讲，我们就是在看病哈。那所有病其实它决定不是基因的表现哈。那基因的表现，它要表现出来，事实上就受到刚刚讲的就是金融、epigenome、environment factor， 还有 age， 还有你的性别等等的因素的影响，会决定它的表现。那个基因，当这个基因表现有问题的时候哈，它就会产生抵抗。啊，一样产生抵抗的过程就是受到基因的影响。那不但如此，我们的基因的表现是从受精卵开始就一直在变，那到我们老了死亡哈，它都一直在变，所以它整个变的话是一个 dynamic 的过程，所以我们一直在产生很大的 big data 哈。那 big data 刚刚校长已经介绍，那这个 big data 有不同的定义哈。有人说是三个 V， 有人说四个 V， 那三个 V 是固定的哈，这个 volume 啊 ，variety， velocity 这是固定的。那第四个 V， 有人讲 velocity， 有人讲 volume 啊，所以也不太一样啊。那基本上大概就是很大的 data 变化多端，非常不肯定哈，就很乱，大概可以这样讲哈。那事实上，在我们的 medical 的 big data， 其实也是具有这些所有的特性，我们也是非常这个各种各样的，比如说你各种各样的检查，所以它的变化性哦，从有 text 有书面有数据有图影像哦，都变化非常多啊。然后每一个经过每一人客观对这个病它的判读。然后它的定义说它晒的那个 ICD number 不太一样，它就会产生很多的误差，所以就产生，所以它是一个标准。事实上，在我们的 medical 里面，它其实是一个标准的 big data。那所以大概我们可以把它分成这样子，就是说，在关于健康有关的 health 的 big data， 大概可以分成 traditional medical data， 那就是包括。你的病例啦，家族史啦，你用药史啊等等的这一些，那再来，我们进入另外一个时代是 omics big data， 就是我们有很多金融的 data， 那包括 microbiome、proteome、metabolomics， 所以等等很多新的这 omics 的更巨大的 data 要加入我们的 medical data 里面，所以这个就是一个我们目前最大的困境，就是如何把这些跟 medical 的，就是在本来是 biomedical 在研究的 data， 现在进入临床了，那如何把这些整合进入我们的临床上，变成一个很快的 real time available 的，可以产生 action 的 data 哈，所以这是我们现在目前最大的问题。然后再加上现在 social media， 还有你的生活形态哦，比如说我们现在很多人手里就带着一个计数器，你今天走多少步哦，你跑多远，所以你的生活的所有的 activity 通通涵盖在里面，啊，这些都是跟健康有关，所以我们现在的。在跟健康有关，就含有这些 data， 那如何把它整合，如何把它应用在真正的在那个人在我们的健康上产生重大的影响，这是我们目前最重要的课题。那我们就以一个健康人，那他变成一个病人，然后到一个医院来看诊，到来拜访的医院，他整个过程一直在产生 big data。哦，比如有一个健康人变成病人的时候，他说到 environment， 说到 lifestyle， 决定他什么时候要变成一个病人。那这个病人他要到一个医院，比如到我们中医大，那他为什么来我们中医大？哦，他的心理的过程，他一个问人谁来介绍他，然后他怎么来的，这个也会产生很多 big data。那到我们中医大以后，他要看一个医师，哦，那他要经过我们的行政人员等等的，才看到我们这个医生。这个过程也会产生一大堆 data， 哦，然后当他看了医师以后，医师下 order 他要干嘛，做什么检查，哦，然后在整个医院的流程，哦，他的 transportation 啊，这个医院的环境怎么样，也是一个很重要的 big data 产生，然后。他到我们的检验 各种各样的检验部门，比如说他的我们的一般的抽血的检验部门、imaging的检验部门或者病理的检验部门，那他就会产生一大堆的 report， 然后在这个过程中他会用一大堆的 facility， 那这个过程也会产生一大堆 big data， 然后经过 doctor 经过这样，然后去判读，哦，他到底需要做什么治疗，他要做什么的，然后用什么药，然后也会产生一大堆 data， 然后到最后他可能 cure， 也可能 say goodbye， 然后 say goodbye 以后就去这个神也要替他做一些处理，那这个也会产生一大堆 big data， 然后他有可能变成一个慢性病，那慢性病以后他可能还要继续的去看病，然后或者他因为他生了病，好了不好了，他就觉得他应该做一些什么事，他就做一些 health promotion， 或者是他心理上产生了改变，精神上的改变，所以他可能有的人就因为好了就 donation 一大堆，有人因为不好了他就开始骂神了，所以这个整个心理过程也会产生一大堆的改变，所以事实上医院是一个产生一个最大 big data 的地方，而且非常集中，所以它应该是一个非常好分析、非常最好最佳的分析场所，其实是在医院。比如说在大陆上有一家医院，一个病人 住院，他就各种各样的 sensor， 他们这个一个实验性的病房，就是一病人一住院以后就产生各式各样的 data， 然后他们就开始一直分析。那比如说。因为我在医院里面是在管检验部的，那一个病人对检验部来讲，就是他产生检体，他身体上所有的东西都会产生检体，从你的尿、你的血液，然后甚至从你的耳垢、你的眼泪，这些通通是检验的材料。那所以这样检验一检完、检查完以后，你会产生一堆病毒。那比如以中医大来讲，我们有将近。现在他要超过2000床，那员工有将近5000人，每天有将近10000人的门诊量，然后急诊有将近500个，住院病人有将近10000个，所以他这个一天就产生一大堆病例， 那检验部来讲，我们 一天、哦、大概会做了20000个 test， 所以你就知道它的 data 有多大、哦、所以事实上我们一直在产生 big data。 那现在这是传统，那现在新的 Omic 的时代来了，所以我们探讨的更细的，我们从染色里谈到探讨到金融，探讨到 cell， 然后探讨它的 systemic change。 那这个过程中我们用一大堆新的 Omic 的技术，所以产生一大堆 Omic 的 data。 那我们如何把这些 data 变成临床可用的一个 data， 那这个就是我们目前最重要的。那事实上第一个其实真正一开始的真正大家认为真正的 big data 其实是做 GWAS 的 study。 它这个因为它每一个晶片大概有将近100万个 SNP， 那每这个100万个 SNP， 然后你要测1000000人，所以你要去分析它跟然后很多 parameter 你要去分析，然后去如何分析它跟病的关系，所以这是一个很大的 data。 所以在早期这个是我们大家常受尽的苦头，那后来就这个整个 data 整个技术成熟了，我们现在已经知道所有跟病有关的位置，它的相关位置在染色体的哪一个位置，现在大概都很清楚。我说 GWAS 的时代其实它现在是已经进入真正的临床的时代，它是已经可以跟你到底你什么样的 SNP 的变化就会在它到底代表是哪一个病，现在这是非常成熟的。那现在我们进入一个更复杂的时代，就是我们有一大堆金融，自从这个 Next Generation Sequencing 开始应用在整个 Biomedical Field 以后，就整个产生更大的变化。我们会有全身每一个每一种细菌微生物，我们在身体上的微生物大于我们的那个就是我们的金我们 cell 的10倍以上的那个微生物，我们也可以把它定型。那当然，我们金融的整个变化 ，epigenome 的变化，还有 transcriptome 的变化，那还有整个这些变化又产生 cytome 的变化 ，metabolome 的变化 ，lipidome 的变化 ，proteome 的变化，所以我们一大堆 omic， 我们如何把这个是已经变成一个越来越会变成一个 routine 的 test， 那这些 routine 的 test 进入了我们的data 以后，我们如何去分析它，如何把它应用，这变成一个很重要的这很重要未来的方向。那其实它所有的这些 data 到最后都会跑到所谓的病例里面，所以它最重要的 core 是在电子病例。所以这个电子病例就每个现在大家全世界我想每个地方都积极在发展。那台湾因为发展的非常快，它事实上它是从为什么会发展这么快，主要是那个我们的全民健保，因为的全民健保就促成了我们台湾在这个健康产业上就比别人更早进场。那国家在这一方面花了很多时间，那我们从98年开始，我们事实上那个全民健保是1994就开始，那我们因为经过了全民健保这个，所以他开始国家觉得很多需要去测去建立的，那所以开始创造就是大家要建立这个电子病历，那从那个1998年开始要如何开始建立一个完整的那个电子病历，所以他有很多补助的计划啦等等，那最后他的目标是要提升医疗品质，促进病人安全，减少医疗资源浪费，生理民众健康管理等等。那其实它最重要的目的就是precision medicine，应该最后就其实就是precision medicine。那事实上美国在2009开始，他们也开始这个电子病历，他们也开始，他们有一个 high tech 的 app 来要来做这一件事。那他们有很多法案，主要一个叫做那个NPRM 的法案的 Minimal Use 等等。那它其实它的方式跟我们台湾是很像，就是 就是补助，然后让你分阶段的补助，让你哎你有多少学生就给你多少钱哦。那这个他们这个他们做的非常非常那个非常彻底哦。那事实上我们做一个比较，就是台湾哦，是因为从1994年开始哦，我们就有全民健保，那所以很多医院就开始哦尽量把。因为你要报健保，所以你很多医院就把电脑引进进来，然后如何用这些 data 去申请那个全民健保的钱。那美国哈，实际上它是主要还是也一样，跟我们很像。那因为他们是，他不是全民健保，他私人公司的，所以他没有全面性，不像我们这么全面。那我们再来就是整个电子病历，那我们在2005年就开始，就有开始提出这个法案，2008、2009就开始把它，所以现在是大量正式在执行。那美国大概是比较晚一点，从2009开始。那我们这个全民健保，这个健保就产生一个叫全民健保资料库。那这个全民健保资料库大概目前全世界我们这个可能是最大最完整的。那比如跟瑞士啊，跟韩国来比，我们它其实我们是可能里面是最好的哦。那因为这个全民健保的资料库哦，那我们台湾哦就产生了将近2000篇左右的 paper， 就到目前为止产生了2000篇的 paper。那特别哦，最近这几年特别从2010年以后就一下子哦突飞猛进的。那我们中医大哦。也抓到这个趋势哦，大概全台湾产生的这个用健保资料库产生的 paper 哈，我们中医大占了差不多1/3左右，所以我们贡献蛮大的，我们的 drive， 那这是我们习总值它的最大的贡献哈。那而且这个 paper 的值都不错哈，有的都可以投到很蛮好的，像 Lancet 啦哦，加码啊，它可以投到这么好的杂志。所以它是贡献很大，但是这个全民健保，其实这些所谓的目前的那个电子病历其实还有很多问题，它就是它的 data 不太完整，特别是因为受电脑容量的关系，常常我们半年左右就要把病那个医院的 data 就要把它储存起来，所以大概它在运算的时候大概只有半年左右。所以你要把过去所有的东西，所以你要把整合，把那个一个病人从头到尾的所检查的，你说要花一点时间再去整合。那所以现在很多医院开始就在做这样的事，就是把这些过去的这些已经在电脑上的很多，特别是像检验，它过去因为 text 方面是比较不完整，但是检验因为它容易。所以它一下子就通通在上电脑，所以你可以很容易做的很多的，所以这个我们目前在台湾目前呢，我看全世界也超不了多少，大概都是你需要把它怎么把它一个病人几十年的看病人的在医院的所有的 data 如果把它连贯在一起，那当然你会牵涉到很多伦理的问题隐私的问题，那这些慢慢的这些法慢慢都出来了。而且这个方法越来越严密，这个我看不觉得将来这个大概不是什么大问题。那再来就是很多 data 它存在不同的地方，比如刚刚我讲的，那有一些 data 它可能在检验，有的在我其他的有像 X 光啊或等等，如何把这些 data 把它整合，那这些 data 当然是非常 complex， 包括 structure 跟 unstructure 等等。所以未来如何把这个目前所有的这些 Omic Data 如何进入这个真正的电子病历，这是一个很重要的课题。那目前关于这个 Big Data 研究大概一年这个量越来越多了，你可以看到它的趋势越来越多。那大概主要是有主要目前主要还是 Omic 的研究为主，还有其他的。那我们大概这个目前这个 Big Data 大概在传统的医学的研究大概可以主要的临床的研究大概可以分成几类，主要 探讨跟 risk factor 的 evaluation 哈，还有那个治疗的 effectiveness 或 intervention 或 prediction 或 流行病学的检查，然后或者是要这个 health policy 的 efficacy 的那个探讨等等，这个目前主要在这一方面哈。那比如说有人就把 big data 的东西用在那个麻醉哈，因为麻醉它会产生很多 sensor 的哦等等哦，病人的很多变化的 data， 血压啦等等的，那你都可以透过这样的东西可能去预测哦，这个病人在麻醉的过程哦，他有没有可能产生什么意外的情形哈，我们可以做很多这样的预测哈。那有人就是把它在探讨全世界哈。他的做那个自体免疫的病哈，他到底有什么？每个自体免疫的病有没有什么特点哈？每个地方的发生的情形有没有什么那个特点？这样有人用它来做这样的东西。那当然，他可以用有人用这样的 technique 来分析这个 genome 的，比如说我们要探讨这个家族他到底他是他的病哈，他是跟哪个基因有关哈？可以用这样的，有人用它来分析这样子，哦，那加拿大他们甚至把它用在他们的移民哦，从全世界各地来的移民哈，他们的患病哈，到底有没有不太一样哈？那他们就比如说他在探讨说，他这个心脏病哈，那全世界各地来移民到加拿大的人哦，他的发生率有没有不太一样？那结果他们发现，好像从台湾来的哈，这个心脏病的人特别少哦。他们得到就是他可以做这样 big data 的东西。那除此之外 ，big data 也可以用在哈，比如像现在在做 radio saver， 那个 radio genomic， 他们就用这样来分析说，哪些病人哈，他做这个 radio therapy 的时候，他比较不会有副作用哦。有人做这样，就是反正。Big data 在那个目前传统上大概都应用在这些方面哈。那我们中医哈，事实上我们也开始把我们这个 Big data 用在我们整个每一天哈，它的 monitor 哈，就是门诊量、病人的活动，就是把刚刚讲一个病人跑到我们的医院，他会产生什么样，他的所有的活动都把它并入到那个 monitor 里面哈，就是。你现在正在这个是医院正在目前正在，就这样。那好，那再来哈，就是 big data 在 omic 方面，刚刚是在我们的就是传统的那个医院里面的分析哈。那再来就是 big data 在这个 omic 的相关的 data。那其实现在最好的一个 data set， 我就每次跟人家讲，刚刚我们看到的就是那个我们台湾的健保资料库。所以我们台湾健保社就很多医院哦，就成立所谓 dry lab， 就专门利用这个健保资料库来做 paper 哦，在探讨这个那个临床上的医疗上的问题。所以到目前为止已经发表了超过2000篇了，一年差不多发表了将近700篇的论文。特别而且这个可能这个其实会还有一阵子的好日子。对不对那我们每次跟大家讲，现在其实应该要进入第二个 dry lab 的时代，就是利用 TCGA 的这个 database， 因为它这个 database 够大，然后够复杂，它里面你看，它有各式各样的 data， 有 exome 的 sequence 的 data， 有 mRNA 的 data， microRNA 的 data， 还有 SNVR 类，还有 proteomic 的 data， 所以它是非常完整、非常复杂的 data， 而且里面有将近30，可能还超过30种 cancer 的 data， 所以这是一个非常棒的一个非常好的，就是你最重要就是赶快把它download下来，那用它去想问一个问题，然后利用这些 data 去做出 paper 哈，啊，所以就很多 paper 都很好的 paper， 他就利用这样，比如他这个人利用刚刚讲的这些各个 database， 然后他分析十二种 cancer， 那到底他有什么特点？这些 cancer 他们有什么共通性？他们就去分析这样子哈，所以他就把很多临床的什么，反正他 data 非常全，因为这个是一个非常棒的 database。那我们也无法泡着，我们问一个问题，因为我们比较实际，我们想说，哎，能不能哈，用很少的几个基因做完以后，我们就可以用这个 panel 去测所有的 cancer， 看看有哪些mutation。然后，假如他测得很，比如80%-90%都测得到，那用很少的基因，然后我用这个当做一个未来要做 monitor 病人的一个那个 panel。所以我只要最我得到这样的，我只要测那几个就好。所以我们那时候就测，哎，好像70几个基因就可以涵盖到90几个，90几%。所以这个我们正在如何把它变成一个实际的东西。那也有人就是去探讨，利用 TGA 去探讨所有那个 cancer 它的 microRNA 的表现的情形。那台湾其实也有开始很多一些人啊，其实还很少，非常少，利用这个 TCGA 的 data 哈，来探讨一些biology 的问题哈。那台湾其实大部分做的就是做 database 哈，就利用这些 data 来建立一些 database， 这是阳明大学他们做的 database。那还有一个就是那个交通大学。黄建达黄教授他们做的，他这个是把他，因为他MicroRNA 的，他这个对他这个网站他已经做好几年，那现在就他又把它 improve， 就是把 genome sequence 的 data 再把它拉进来，所以用那发表已经啊发表在 NAR 里面，所以这个很多基本功都你要做，然后再来就是看 state of art 有什么东西再把它加进去。那这是北医一个叫做张伟乔教授的，他们就分析利用 TCGA 的 data， 他去看了 colorectal cancer 他的那个一些里面的跟 STEAM 这个基因的那个的表现的情形。那事实上哈，这个我们知道这个 TCGA 是大概从2011、2012的时候开始 open 给大家呢。只要申请大概就那，现在越来越松，越来越好申请啊。但事实上，在全世界哦，它已经每一年已经开始在大量产生 paper， 所以这是一个非常好的一个 database， 大家要赶快进场去好好用它。那现在大概的趋势是这样，就是说，刚刚那个只是分析，那你投的杂志哦，都还不错，都。假如你用 SCI 算点数的话，它都6分以上。那最好的 paper 它事实上就是要 integration， 就是你要把哈，就是除了它那个 data， 你还要再去看其他的 database， 把它 integration， 写出程式如何去应用它。所以现在好 paper， 大概最近一两年的 paper 大概都是 integration 的 paper 哈。哦，比如这个它是做100多个 tissue， 它的表现的情形。他做了这个用 big data 分析去看他这样哦，把他收集的他的 publication 然后基因 information 的对他各种 database 都填的 database 然后去发表，那也有用 share 的那个，那一样就反正现在就是你要他这个探讨 immune pathway 跟已有的关系，那你就是要利用现在已有的 database 里面的东西然后去回归性。当然，目前大概的方向大概都是这样子，大概都是这样。有 L proteomic， 就 TCGA 的那个 data 还是不太够哦，所以你还要很多其他的 database， 你要把它通通把它 integration 进来，然后去分析它。啊，这个其实就是未来真正的方向，就因为你要应用在临床上，你最后终极的目标 就是要产生一个 actionable 的那个 strategy， 所以你要马上产生，特别你在看病的时候，它这个是一定要 real time， 所以这个是很重要的。那大概主要是大概是这样子哈。那在美国，它因为这个 big data 在太重要哈，所以他们就有一个测一个计划，叫 big data technology， 他们就组了一个很重要的哈。很多那个大学都参与这一个哦，它主要有12个 center， 你好好看他们，你都 computer， 然后不然就是所谓的金融，所谓的金融 data 的分析，然后 real typing 的分析，哦 data， 怎么分析 data 等等哦，其实你可以看到它的每一个，就是刚刚讲的，就是它其实都是绕着医院的 big data 在转。医院未来会产生什么样的 big data？ 它其实它最重要的策略其实都是在这里哦，所以它最重要的说，哎，你如果利用这些 center， 然后而且要 sustainable， 然后要产生 so， 它各种各样的 so， 喂等等，还要教育等等哦，所以他们大量哦，就是他们非常积极在处理这一件事哈。那我认为哈，那大概这个其实是一个非常好的时代。是不管是 computer science 或者医院，通通大家都是一个非常好的时代。那我们知道，就医院的 big data， 它其实它就围绕着 patient 在转，就是刚刚我讲，一个病人，他到医院落了1000以后，他产生一大堆 big data， 这个病人，他包括他 behavior 的 big data， 跟诊断有关的 big data。跟 treatment 有关的 big data， 还有新加入的各种 omic 的 big data， 还有 hospital， 你要这个 hospital 整个运作的 big data， 哦，然后还有就是很多包括很多新的资料哈，等等的 big data， 哦，还有在 social meaning 等等跟 disease 有关的那些。啊、这些只要跟病人有关的这些 big data， 我们如何把这些 big data 把它整合？也就是说，我们所有包括新的这个 molecular profile 和 omic 的 data， 还有现在 clinical 上，你如何把这 omic data 要什么 interpretation， 然后如何利用来治疗病人？那最后就是透过这样，那我们就达到一个可以做到这所谓的 precision medicine。那因为这些 data 它都太复杂，所以我们需要一大堆哈人来参与，那才能处理这么复杂的 data。那所以我们要很多方法。那比如说过去哈，这是最出名 big data 最出名，就是预测嘛，这个流行性感冒的发生。那这2007的时候，刚好在 Google 发表的时候，哦，很震惊。那后来发现他的方法其实不太好，预测哦不太准，所以要 improve， 所以现在就 improve 了很多方法，哦，所以也就是说，在这个 big data 的还很多可以发展，就是很多方法其实都在婴儿期而已，需要很多的改进，哦。那特别是未来这个 hospital 里面这些 big data 还没有。其实还没有真正用，所以那很多工具我们都不知道它是什么样子，所以这是需要我们很多的。那事实上就是我们刚刚讲一个，我们现在所有的在 hospital 里面产生一大堆各式各样的这些药物整合，所以我们需要去分析及整合各种 omic 的变化，我肯定可以，这是最目前最重要，因为Omega 现在这些 data 几乎其实还在 research， 真正临床应用，比如说以金融 sequence 也是才开始的。那我们要把这 Omega data 如何再整合到我们的电子病历里面，然后如何把这些 data dynamic 把它这些 dynamic data 把它分析，建立那分析的方法。那如何把这些所有的 hospital related data 去产生一个 real time 的 action， 那再来就利用这样去 prevention 那个 prediction prevention personal prediction 等等，也就是达到这个 precision medicine 的目标哦。其实这个是我们未来的方向哦。那所以我们需要很多这个人来合作哦，这些这个太复杂了哈，这不是医师所能干的事哈。医师其实快要被淘汰，就我们习总之每次跟我们问一个问题说，你们认为医师未来会不会被取代？我们当然反对啊，但事实就摆在这眼前，很快的医师不太有用哈，所以开始哈，那所以当然我们这些所有的目的哈，就是要把在就是在整合到那个电子病历里面。产生一个重要的那个，比如说，这是我的检验部哈，那我的检验部现在已经不太像检验部哈，就跟传统很好看。我现在有一个叫生物资讯组，这个大概全世界的检验部哈，我这个可能要排在最前面。我真的是要生物资讯的人来分析，因为我发现医检师跟医师都没办法承担这个工作，所以一定要有生物资讯，所以。我的一个博士，在今年哈，就生物资讯人正式进入我们要我还有一个博士的哈，要进入来做分析哈，分析这个，所以这个是，那比如说你Mayo Clinic他们也开始在Big Data 或者 Omic 等等的哈，就刚刚我们讲的哈，他们已经把它在整合这样，那这个大家都还开始，所以还很多机会，那也就是说。事实上 ，data 越来越多了，那这些这么多的 data， 你要怎么搞呢？所以我们需要很多人哦，要数学家 ，computer scientist， 然后 data 的 scientist， 哦 ，bioinformatics 等等的，那有这么多的复杂的 data， 那我们才能把这些 data 变成 information 组合，变成 knowledge， 然后产生一个 real time action， 变成信息。这个就是我们 hospital big data 的味道，就是这样。大家，谢谢大家。
谢谢张教授非常精彩的演讲啊。那么我们现在还有十分钟，是不是大家看有没有什么问题可以提出来？
Very interesting talk. I learned a lot from the summary. So I have a curiosity question. So, what are the successful stories for the you have experience for cross-discipline researchers? For example, other discipline like engineering, like system engineering, data scientists, computer scientists, working with your medical scientists. What are the success stories?
问你就是说，我的过去有没有什么成功的历史，跟这些人合作的历史啊？其实我是有一点经验的哈。那过去我跟交大的黄教授，那现在他有一个学生叫做那个文林。那文林，我先跟你们介绍一下，他是以前我的一个秘书。他在我实验本来是秘书，那我叫他哈，我的实验室是专门在做 biomedical 的，是做一个 relay， 是真正在做实验的对。那文林哈，因为秘书那时候我就觉得好像这个生物资讯 bio 非常重要，所以我叫他你去读这个 biomedical， 所以他就去找那个黄宪啊，刚刚有边他们在专门在做。Microarray Database 那个黄教授，然后他就他去当他的学生，那因为这样我们就产生了一个很好的联系，所以在过去我们主要的研究是在看了，就说我们那时候问了一位他的博士论文就是这样，他我们问一个问题就是说，这个金融里面产生很多 RNA 哈，那这些 RNA 哈，过去因为我们对 Microarray 不太清楚。我们想，会不会有一些 RNA， 它会变成一个小的 RNA， 那它不一定是 microRNA 作用，所以我们就问这样的， 所以他的博士论文就是，哎，就发现了有一些 transcript 的 small 的 RNA， 然后他可以，他有一些他就有一些就很像那个 micro RNA 的作用。那后来我们就在问题中，哎，会不会那个产生一大堆 RNA 哦，它就是它没有表现什么基因，不表现 protein， 但是它有什么功能？所以我们就后来做了一些那个许多基因那几张 protein RNA 的网站，那这个就是我跟巴宇那个合作的那个。那现在我的实验室现在在成立了这个为什么要的生物之前，因为我们临床上会产生很多sequence的 data， 基因sequence 的 data。过去我几年就吃到很多亏，就是那sequence完又不知道怎么分析的，啊，随便跟你讲一下，啊你也我就吃尽了苦头，好，所以现在我们就哎，经过我们跟这些导演里面的合作以后，我们就发现哎，而且他们没有临床的经验，所以他们需要，因为我们要告诉他，哎，你要怎么分析。所以我现在变成我在教那些生物之前说，哎，你要怎么分析才能符合临床的意向、临床的要求？你要怎么把你的分析的结果变成一个 report？ 因为 medical report 它有它的要求要那个，所以你要如何把你的这个金融的所有的 data？ 所以刚刚我讲，喂，你要这些人怎么合作，变成一个 real time action about 的 strategy 是非常重要的。所以这个就是需要我有 medical 的人，因为他有每一样都有规范，你要一个 report 的他有规范，你要做到什么情形才能说服病人，才能说服医师，大概就是这样。
好，那个，
我看到说您把那个 bioinformatics 放在那个很下面的一个 organization structure。在我们医院里面呢，我们大概是有600 beds 的那个 hospital， 我们的那个 bioinformatics 是在非常上面的一个位阶。
哦，那你们更重要。
所以我在想说，我们在这里很多老师是 bioinformatics 老师，想说，哎，那我们的学生毕业之后是那个在这个 area 呢，还是您有那个 vision 说我们怎么 grow？
他不是位，他那个 structure 不是位阶的，等一下，那你看看那一个。他其实他位阶不低啊，他其实是这样，就是说这个就是告诉我们一个信息，就是说这个巴以我们那个人是要进入医院变一个重要的一个部门的，啊，他其实他是一个部门，那再来其实还要告诉大家，就是说你假如把那个扩大，就是因为这是其中一个小小的检验部而已，你就整个医院来讲，他是要一个。他要一个特别的单位，要把 computer scientist、mathematician 等等哦，变成形成一个单位，专门来处理医院的 big data。其实他真正的 strategy 应该是这样子。那我那个只是因为那个只是在解决我的金融的问题而已，他没有解，还没有达到要解决医院的问题啊。所以那个其实也不小，那个是一个主任级的。他现在是因为人来派的，他是一个主任圈，就是我们一个 section， 他其实等于就是说我们检验部里面有很多个 section， 他是 section chief 的，是很大的职位。
还有一个，那我们学校老师有没有什么这个？我们还有一些时间。
看起来这个 big data 看起来大部分都是以好像统计哈 summarize 之后来做 study， 但是如果我是一个个人的话，我是一个 patient， 我会比较在乎说我在 A 医院跟 B 医院所检查的结果，可能他告诉我这是那个病，这是那个病，或是有的说你只能活几个月，啊，另外一个说你活几个月，我是一个 patient， 我比较在乎。像这种情况呢，我们有没有类似曾经有过什么样的一个 study 说？从这个 database 里面，我们发现某个医院的诊断方式不好的，或者某个医院是比较好的，某个方法是比较好的等等，有没有这样的一个 case？ 谢谢。
在我们这边是还没有的。那在美国，它有 hospital ranking， 他们是有这样的。那在台湾，我们是还没有把这个 data， 因为未来是可以做到这样子。因为未来你每个医院你的所有的那个电子病历弄完以后。你会去统计哈， 你这个病哈，在这个医院为什么？其实现在是在癌症，某些癌症是有在做这样的比较，就哎，我在这个癌症，这个医院为什么活得比较久？你在另外一个癌症为什么？是这个是在美国有啊，在我们台湾是慢，但是因为我们因为国情的关系，大部分都不公布。
没有问题，这个机会难得。好好，那么谢谢张教授啊。现在的资料啊，越来越这个 open 哈，像我们这个刚刚讲的这个 medical， 可能有一些啊，比如说医生是谁做这个诊断你不晓得，可是我们在这个 research community 哈，那个很容易他们就帮我们排，就统计出来说，哦，你最近的 research paper publication 是意见啊。啊、以前你跟哪一个老师是你是比他好，现在比较差哈，就做这种 comparison， 有时候非常的这个 embarrassing。那么接下去呢，我就介绍一下这个刘老师哈。那我们刚才讲，刚才也有讲过哈，这是 international conference， 但是你可以用你喜欢的语言哈，啊，英语啊，或者是中文哈，或者是哈那个刘教授呢，他是研究做得非常好。我刚刚讲的那个就是本来这个比较哈，越来这个，就是我的 case 就是这样哈。我看到刘老师的时候，第一次见面的时候，他好像还刚到美国没多久，所以我就看到他这个在他这个领域，在我们的领域啦，我们基本上是相同领域。然后他这个做得非常非常好，现在已经发表300多篇的论文哈，而且他在那个刚校长有讲过，就是说 editor in chief 的 ACM Transactional Service Service Computing 啊，那他也担任过这个一些重要的这个期刊的这个 editor 哈，包括这个 ACM 的 ACM Transactional on Web 啊 on Internet Technology。IGV Transactional Knowledge and Data Engineering 啊，还有 VLDB Journal， 这都是这个我们这个领域最顶级的 Journal 啊。他也在他的那个 paper 也发表在 Best Paper Award 在很多的这个 conferences 啊。那同时他现在也是 IGV Fellow， 那他也在2012年得到这个 IGV 的这个 Computer Society 的这个叫做Technical Achievements Award 啊，对。所以这个我们欢迎啊刘教授。
我先想谢谢这个蔡校长，还有呢，我今天 surprise to see the Abe is here， we are old friends also， so， I can answer questions in Chinese， 我可以回答问题用中文回答问题，但是我要讲话我还是比较less stressed when you speak English. Because of Jeffrey, 蔡校长叫我讲这个 healthcare 和 big data， 所以我呢，准备了一下，我想讲几个方面，所以说我就是准备了一下三个方面，然后我现在就用英文讲。So the first, I want to talk a little bit on the big data trend.So just very quickly introduce what I want to talk about. The three areas that I really want to talk about is the first one is what is the innovation that we really need to enhance the data mining statistic learning method to actually handle the real big data challenge, and especially in the healthcare. So the second type of challenge is not really in the healthcare, but it's in computing, in technology.So what type of challenge that in the big data domain that especially from the healthcare experiences, we can see that we really need innovation in computing and in order to actually handle the big data challenge, to actually help the healthcare a scientist to actually advance and in a faster speed. And the last thing that I also want to talk a little bit is on the how do we deploy the technology in the healthcare, and what are the innovation that we really need to work on also to actually moving this forward. So that's kind of three areas that we'll talk about. The first thing I want to just quickly go through the house data. Because we all know that digital data is in every aspect of our life, including our personal life, government, and our working environment, and also in healthcare. And actually, the data in healthcare is big asset. Basically, every stakeholder and treasure that data and holding that data as their own asset. So in these kind of areas, basically, there's a lot of challenge in how to do big data research in healthcare, especially what kind of data are available for researchers and how to integrate among different disciplines, different backgrounds of researchers and to actually help with the challenge. For example, the Professor Chang has talked a lot of areas and challenges, including the data integration, one of the hardest ones. And if you look at a US a statistics, basically from McKinsey Consulting, they basically list that US has a four pool of data in healthcare, but they don't talk to each other. And the stakeholders holding the data for their own purposes. So it's actually harder to actually look at the integrated solutions. Now, as a technologist, if you don't have a data, you don't have a problem, then you do not have the way to develop the tools and services and systems that can help. So therefore, there's an awful synergy between the people and the background of scientists that are looking into this. And also, we need a lot of case studies, need a lot of scenarios and for people who work in this area to actually enhance the technology and provide things that are easy to use for medical scientists. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about is I will just quickly go through one case and then I'll look into the three innovation challenges. So this is from one of the companies who are looking at different big data use cases in healthcare. And the reason I like this five use cases is because actually they represent the five different areas that both a information technologist and a healthcare professionals, they all interested in. And for example, the first one, and Professor Chang already said, even in a university, like at China Medical University, the number of papers grow a lot, right? Today, the most of the literature grows so much, no single researcher in the same field can read all the papers by themselves. So therefore, the text-based mining, text-based search, is a very, very powerful tool for researchers, for medical doctors, and for medical professionals. But how to enhance the search capability is really a big issue. Even though there's lots of paper, lots of research, but still, they're not sufficiently easy to use, they're not sufficiently high quality. And there's also other type of application. So I'm gonna just talk about the telemedicine. So if you look at the telemedicine area, it's really growing very fast. And from the simple type of telemedicine devices and the capabilities to more sophisticated cases. Actually, I had one experience. I went to the Seattle mountain to hiking after a conference, and I fall, and then my leg was broken. So I went to the hospital, and they, in the middle of night, so therefore, because I had to get back from the mountain and go to the city and then go to the hospital. And they actually did a telemedicine to a doctor's home, and to take the picture of my bones and send to his home, then he diagnosed and then gave me back the result, and then they gave me a certain kind of treatment so that I can fly back to Atlanta to do the serious treatment. And so basically, it's really a growing area. It's very, very important, not only for the city life, but also for rural areas. That's a very important tools to increase the quality of life and the quality of the healthcare. But my experience is very expensive. So that treatment I have, my insurance has to pay a lot. Because I went to the best hospital and they had all the high-tech technology. It was good, but insurance is going to pay a lot for that. If the people don't have a good insurance, probably it's not affordable. Okay, so that area really is one of the areas that really reduces the cost. It's really important because people living enhance a lot of people's life and the quality of treatment. Okay, second thing that I want to talk a little bit is the future. I like this cartoon a lot. So this is basically saying that maybe in the future, just like a photo booth, you could go into a medical treatment booth, wear the medical clothes, and then the sensor would sense the things in your body and send the information to a telemedicine center. And then you have specialists diagnose your symptoms and provide advice and prescriptions and suggestions. And that's are actually something really like a fantasy, but it might be possible in the future. And to make this possible, you need a lot of computing technology, communication technology, multimedia technology, in addition to healthcare and medical medical professionals' knowledge and expertise. So these are basically a blend of technology that can make this possible as a future. And the innovation that probably can make people rich, and they can make people famous, and can save a lot of lives. Okay. So, and last thing in the, before I talk about the technical part is what I think is in the future, we are looking at a healthcare enterprise, it's really analytics driven. So whether they are doctors and using analytics from their own knowledge, from their what they learned in the school, what they learned in the practical environment, and combined with big data analytics, and as a very useful alternative, a reference point for the medical specialists. And how to make this blend, and that is a challenge for all of us, whether we're in the bioinformatic area, computing area, engineering area, there are lots of different technology can contribute to this blend between the small high quality knowledge versus large and low quality but huge data. And that's actually an interesting endeavor for a lot of us. Now let's look at analytics. If you look at the analytics domain, and what we have today is a database we have. Everybody using database. And we have a file system database. We put data in there. We can ask what we put in. And the basically, we do certain kind of simple analytics. But as we move to a higher level analytics, basically, even in the database, if we want to say, okay, from the data, tell me what's the problem, that becomes harder. And if you say, I want to drill down to what action I should take, it becomes even harder. And if you want to really do predictions and to do controls over the medical situation, it becomes even harder. So today we're looking at prediction as the hardest problem. But after prediction, it's a control. Because ultimately, the doctors want to control your bad symptoms, control the progression of those bad symptoms. And that is an even harder problem, right? So we are looking forward to what kind of research topics, what kind of algorithms that we could develop that actually can push forward the innovation in both medical domains and in technology domain. So therefore, I'm going to talk about the second part. So in this area, there's lots of algorithms, lots of data types. So I'm going to pick up time series analysis, because this is one of the areas that has a lot of challenge. And the most of the healthcare data, they are time series based. And like Professor Chang said, a lot of sequence data. You look at sequence, you don't know what you're looking at. And if you have multiple sequences, how do you correlate those sequences? It's even harder problem. So therefore, there's a lot of possibility for innovation. And so I'm going to just use that as example. If you look at time series data, what is time series data? It's really a collection of observations. The observation can be made by humans, can be made by sensors, can be made by a different kind of medical instrument. And then most of the time series data has a certain variables that you would like to observe, and you would like to understand the patterns of the change of those variables and try to infer certain kind of statistic patterns. And however, the observation order is very important. That's why we call them time series data. And if you look at the most simplistic time series data, it's our heart rate. And when we do exercise, we measure our heart rate. When we do a mountain hiking, we measure our heart rate. Because if you don't have a normal heart rate, and they you can have a lot of maybe sweat that are causes these waves. So then if you look at this heart rate, then you have systems, which is your cardiovascular systems. You have a process, which is your heart rate, and then you have your time series data, which is a measurement of the electrical activities of your human heart, right? So this basically says that every time series data, you are looking at the systems, you're looking at processes, you're looking at the signals, which is the sensed values. Now, if you look at the time series analysis, how many different ways you analyze that? And how many different ways you learn about time series analysis? At least I can see you have four broad categories. The first one is simply collect time series data, describe it. And using database query, you can query them, you can describe them. But that's very simplistic, but still, that's what we can do. The second thing is you need to interpret the time series data. Now today, we interpret the time series data by using some other time series data. Because time series, if you are taking single variables, you are doing time series, you can't explain this a lot. And only you can see is within certain time window, there's a certain repeated patterns. So by using some other type of time series data that you can interpret what's happening, why there is a statistic, a pattern, why there's downward, why there's an upward or downward pattern. So that's kind of a typical situation. If you look at the stock market, if you look at the price as a time series data, what do you interpret that? You use the company news, you use the volume of transactions to try to interpret why the stock price is going up and going down, all kind of stable. So that's second kind. And that's already very challenging. Now, the next one is prediction. Prediction is basically, you look at the past of the time series data. You want to predict what is the next possible point. And that signal then for this point. And if you look at a stock market, price. And most of the hedge fund companies, they really want to hire smart people, have very good statistical mathematical training, so they can predict what is next a market against. And where is the stock tomorrow is going to be. Whether the stock is going to be going up, going down, how much percent is going up and going down. You can know that. You'll probably be the richest man in the world. Now the question is, it's still very hard. Today, even the stock market research has been 30 years, and they only have a three time series data, which is price, volume, and news. And they still do not know how to predict. Whether just three bucket, predict tomorrow's price is going to go up, going down, or stable. And the precision of that prediction is really low, not very good. Okay, so what's the problem? So that's prediction. Now the next one, what I can see, and especially in the healthcare domain, is really, really important. Because in the stock market domain, there's many, many factors to control a company's price to make it going up. Okay? You can still control it, but you need a lot more factors, you need a lot more mastery of money to do that. Now in health domain, the doctors, they want to control the time series observation they have into the human body. And they want to use medicines, they want to use medical treatment to control the progression of that time series. So therefore, control of this kind of process, and by influencing it, by observing the changes in that time series data, and to enforce certain kind of a property change to control the path of the future, that is even harder. Okay, so that's why I said time series analysis is one of the biggest things, but there's so many new challenges. Now, if we just take the time series of prediction, forget about anything else, just prediction, okay? So if you look at the literature, most time series predictions, they basically ask a simple question, okay? If you store the time series in the database, you only ask, do you see a trend? Do you see a pattern based on time windows? If you see a pattern, okay, let's go to the trend model to see what kind of trend we want to model. And then how do we learn about the noise in the data? So we can actually manage the noise and then figure out certain kind of interesting patterns that we can use that to do predictions. Okay? So you can have an upward, downward, a trend. You can have a cyclic trend. You can have a seasonal trend. you can have the regular trench, you have a lot of trench. Now, if you say, I don't have a trench, I cannot see anything from a time series, then like zigzag, zigzag, doesn't have a trench. Then you need to smooth it. So then you need to take a look at a moving average and take a look at exponential smoothing to smooth it into a regular path. And by taking windows of time series data and producing moving average, producing exponential smoothing a bias, and then produce another type of aggregated time series data and try to see whether you can see patterns now. Okay? And once you are having a trend model, you also have to decide how you do regression analysis so that you can actually find the patterns and find the clusters, find the classification significance. So these are areas that how people stay today working. Now the entire whole thing is on single time series data. You have single time series data, how do you learn the trend in that time series? And that's the complete state bar that you work on, okay? So now, if you look at the smoothing models, the most of the time, the difficult part is how do you define the windows, the n's? Because I need to do an n period, a moving average. So therefore, I need to figure out what is my time window. And if the time window is not selected properly, you lose the patterns. You lose the significance. And so therefore, the scientist has to study, okay, if I use a 4-week window, I use 6-week window, or I use 2-week window, or 10-week window, what is the best indicator? Now that is kind of a feature extraction. Now if we do data mining, we know if we do clustering, we know classification, we do the simple data feature extraction. These are not more sophisticated features. We have to learn how to extract before we can even analyze and predict. Okay, so that's challenge. And also, if you are thinking the simple moving average is too simple, then you need to look at a weighted moving average. And you can use a uniform weight, you can use a diverse weight. And then you have to use mathematical statistical models to learn those weights as you analyze different windows of time series data to learn what is the best weight for different particular position in the time window. Maybe you pick time window of 2 weeks, Monday is always more important than Friday, then that you have to figure that out, okay? And then that is also challenging. Next thing is, whenever you have this kind of a moving average formula to clean your data, to extract better features, you also have objectives. And then you have to define certain accuracy goals. And most of the time, people use a mean squared errors, okay? So therefore, in the medical domain, also you have people are sometimes also use the mean absolute derivations. So it doesn't matter what you use. These are the simplistic error measures, right? And for sophisticated cases, we don't even have error measures. Without error measure, how do we convince the medical researcher this is some big data inference that you can trust? Okay. So therefore, even in the measuring the accuracy area, there's a lot more innovation required. So today, almost all the statistical mining, they are using a mean squared error or root mean squared error. Or they use simply just a little bit diverse using mean absolute derivation just to see different aspects of statistical metrics. Okay, so that's actually interesting part. Next thing is I'll just quickly talk a little bit on the exponential smoothing then leading to the difficulty in multivariate and time series analysis. So there are researchers already looking at, okay, moving average, weighted moving average are too simplified, and they may not represent a certain type of time series a trend. Therefore, and looking at exponential smoothing, and this is a simplistic exponential smoothing by introducing a coefficient, a smoothing constant. And then basically with a higher probability, you'll take a sample of the t time. And by one of the alpha, a probability, you'll take the previous smoothing value and to produce the current smoothing value. Okay, so that's a simplistic model we all use in most data mining research. And with different alpha parameters, give you different trend. However, your time series data, which trend is the best trend? You can see based on different alpha, the line is very different. But how do you choose? How do you pick? If you just pick a default, you tell doctor, doctor will make big mistakes by using your data analysis. Okay? So how do you actually pick this up? Okay? Now, next thing is, people say, okay, this exponential small thing is too simple. Maybe we should revise it with a multi-step smoothing. So then you're introducing a second level smoothing parameter data. After the first round of smoothing on the time series point I observe, I do a second level smoothing on the smooth leg. And then you can go on with that. And then you can combine these two smoothing to predict, to give you the prediction value, which is in time t plus 1 point, what will be the value that you will observe. Okay, and that is very important for patients, right? So I will talk about that right after this one, okay? So now the question here is, there's also a lot of research on different ways to improve smoothing quality and using different kind of external knowledge, like time series data that represent a certain kind of a cyclic factor. Even they are cyclically growing trend, but they are cyclically upward trend or cyclically downward trend. And all they're kind of oscillating between that. So there's a lot of factors you can introduce. Therefore, huge amount of data in this area. Okay? Now, what I want to say is that even this single time series analysis, you can also combine different forecasts, a time series forecasting model. And again, it's on the same time series data. You can do all kinds of associations, learn this by this weight, and to combine multiple time series analysis model. And you gave an ensemble, right? You gave an analytic ensemble. And you still have to learn the weight of the ensemble in order to understand what is the final prediction you have. However, if you look at the medical domain, so this is one of the things I learned. So I was trying to work with the medical doctors. And as a researcher in computer science, we are looking for funding to fund our PhD students. So, and the medical domain is one of the areas that NIH fund a lot. Okay? So I went to the Emory Hospital through multiple connections to find their directors in the emergency room, ICU unit. So we went there, and he said, okay, I just want to present to you the difficulty we have. Number one, I go to the emergency room, and every emergency room has a computer screen. And that computer screen displays many sensors, more than 24 sensors on the screen. And there are little windows on the screen, there have a curves. And then you will hear every room in front of that screen, there's a beep, 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 beep all the time. Because whenever the sensor is exceeding that particular curves threshold, then they beep. They warn the emergency doctors. And then all these doctors laughing, chit-chat, have fun. And then I was looking at that, I said, these guys are all dying. You guys are still chatting. He said, you know, Lin, this is our life every day. Okay? We now know all these guys, they are going to be okay tomorrow, so they should go home, make room for other ICU unit patients, or they should stay here because they're dying. And so basically he said, you know, in the medical school, what we learn is a single time series data. When it's a high blood pressure, low blood pressure, high glucose level, and high heart rate, that I know, we learn that. But the combination of that, what is the combination of that? How to analyze that to understanding, simply to put this ICU patient into three buckets. They're getting stable, they're improving, they're getting worse. Just putting in three buckets so we could actually analyze that, giving them a better attention, we cannot know. But if a patient doesn't have anything beeping, they shouldn't be here. Everybody here is going to have a multiple factors beeping all the time. So he said, I don't know. Okay, we study the stock market prediction. And we think those things cannot be even used for us. But today's stock market cannot even predict. Okay, so that's what's their story, right? So if you look at stock market, I did actually go to look at stock market. And if you look at star market, and you have curves, you have the volume, you have the news, you have the price. And what stock market people do is they cut these time series into windows. They do a 5 day, 10 day, and all 5 point, 10 point window. And then they try to compare different lengths of windows to decide which window is the best cut. And the goal here is we want to find, if I can find in my entire time series data, if every window tells me consistent observation, means in the price, it's kind of stable and a little bit going down, and in the news, it's going to be bad news a lot more, and in the volume, they're going to be slightly go down. That means this three time series can be integrated easily because they are all telling the same trend. Now we can use one to integrate the other tool, so we're set. So if the emergency room doctor can see all the 24 sensors have these kind of windows, then they are happy. But in reality, what you have is this kind of thing. Because you don't know how to choose window. And this is really hard because it's a feature extraction. So therefore now what you have is you have some cases going down, some cases going up, some cases going slightly stable. Then how do you conclude? What is tomorrow's price? Going down, going down, all stable. Now you have only three time series in the entire stock market 30-year research. I look at literature, most literature on single time series. They don't even consider others. Recently they start considering others. They use SVM on both, on three. So they say, okay, do a SVM model on each of them and do a simple majority voting. That's it. Okay? But that's something very hard for medical domain because stock market we can kind of understand as human. Even computer science can understand. You go to a medical domain with all these sensors, we don't even understand the medical meaning. How do we do research? Then you ask the doctor, I said, John, how do we do this? He said, don't ask me, I don't have knowledge. I don't know. I didn't learn this. So there's a lot of doctor has experience, but the experience is case by case basis. So we have to learn. So you need to send your student to my lab to learn. And then they said, I have a data, but the data by HIPAA is not allowed to collect. So therefore, my president allows me to collect data and in this lab, and only for study purposes. And therefore, I cannot give you, you have to come here. Now, how many of my students want to come here? No, unless you fund them. But if it's just for exploratory research, we don't have students who want to do this. You see that, right? So basically, it's a difficult area. And he hired a postdoc to do this and doesn't have a result. So basically, he said, I don't have made ready tools that I can use. If I have to do computing research, I don't do. Okay? But this is actually kind of really interesting area that I say time series analysis has a lot of potential. Okay? Now, what are the possibilities? Okay, I'm just thinking about two types of possibilities. Okay? One is, if you look at time series data, you just take the whole time series data, it's going to be really not good for you. The noise is too big. So then how do you actually figure out another way to clean this data? By grouping time series data of similar type of patients, taking similar type of treatment and similar type of drugs, and to putting set of data patients into a group. And then you can analyze time series using those data, and maybe you get something, rather than just taking a single patient's time series data for the entire treatment days, right? So there is a certain kind of analogy you can use, just like we use a social network, we learn how the social behaviors by using collective filtering. Now why can we try that? But we have to use similar type. We cannot use anybody's, right? If I have a cancer treatment for colon cancer, it's very different than I have a cancer treatment for breast cancer. So you cannot use the same thing. And second thing is, for trajectories, we have studied the trajectory for mobile systems. We have a pretty successful result. And the mobile data is a time series tool. And so therefore, there has to be a way to also classify trajectories and find interesting groups. Even though you don't have a username, they are all blanked out because of the privacy reasons, you can still try to figure out how to group them in certain ways that actually you can find more higher quality data to do analysis. Okay, so that's first thing. Second thing is ensemble. I'll talk a little bit quick. So if you have a medical record data, instead of looking at a single patient's entire hospital stay, the time series data, because it's huge already. Because every moment you measure, if you have 12 body sensors, you have generated lots of data already. But by looking at that data, you cannot infer a lot because the complicated medical treatment, medication, and the side effect of that, nobody single person can understand all aspects. So what we can do is maybe we identify a group of users that you have a similar type of treatment, similar type of result. Maybe that would give us a little bit better indicator. And that is something computing are very good at. Okay, computer science is very good at. Okay, so if we can do that, then if we have a big EMR data from the hospital, and giving a patient, you can identify a set of similar users, and given a set of similar users, you classify them based on the type of treatment, type of medication, type of a complication they have, and then you can actually group them into groups. And then you study time series analysis on that group, and probably you get a little bit better indicators. So that's one kind of thing. I didn't study, I don't have data. Okay? I'm just thinking, that's a possibility, okay? Now, next thing I want to talk a little bit is the power of ensemble, okay? The ensemble is basically learning by using many different learning models. Each learning model represents one expert. And then if you consolidate a large number of expert knowledge, you may actually produce a better quality of learning, okay? And what I want to talk about is, let's take a look at the today's state of art is really primitive. Today's state of art is pseudo consensus, which is no supervised, no learning, just majority voting. You take 10 models and let them learn, and solving one problem, same data set. Okay, come back, majority. If you have majority, you recommend that. If you don't have, well, it's too hard for you. Oh, start learning with more models. Okay, or you cut data into multiple samples, or you do multiple different rounds of sample collection, and then each sample collection you learn, and then you combine, and give you different views of the data, and then you try to look at the result. That's another ensemble. So ensemble learning is powerful, but how to innovate in an ensemble model, that is hard still, okay? So there is two successful stories. Number one is the IBM story. Okay, I'll just talk about it. So IBM, you know, Jeopardy game, that IBM wouldn't make. That's why they start selling their Dr. Watson. Now, IBM's ensemble learning for the Watson and the, you're smarter than the seventh grader, right? So what they do is they use 100 plus learning algorithms. For every question on the board, they run all of them, and then they cut off a certain time off. And then after timeout, take all the answers. If there's a majority, that is answer IBM's Watson will provide. Because of that, they have to be the human expert, okay, in doing that. That's the first story. And IBM didn't publish a lot on that because they keep that as secrecy so they can sell more money for the healthcare equipment. And they are pushing it the last 10 years now, and the success not as good as the Jeopardy game. Why? Because Jeopardy game is a simple text search. And with Dr. Watson, you are handling real complicated healthcare situation. For each particular discipline, each particular type of disease, probably you need a lot more study. You cannot just looking at literature to find solutions. So that's why there are a lot more complications. Now, Netflix is not a very successful, but they report a lot. So what they have is they say, okay, we have $1 million prize, and anybody who can improve 10% over my Netflix current movie, a recommendation classifier's error rate, then I'm gonna give you $1 million. So currently I have a 0.95 error rate. I want to drop it to 10%, okay? So in the competition, there are 40, at least 40 teams, they actually get a 5% in the first 4 weeks. But nobody reached very high. So at the end, these 40, their set of teams start talking. They said, maybe we should combine. So they start, among the teams, they start combining their algorithms. And then they are getting higher rate. Okay? So this basically shows that statistically, if you combine your learning models, you can increase the accuracy. Okay? Now, why this is good? And there's a lot of reasons. So you do bagging, you do boosting. This is a typical way of learning. And I think my slides. slide jump a lot. Because I suppose, yeah, okay. So today, the ensemble world, there's only two approaches. One is a bagging approach, just consensus-based. You bag the result there, you take the majority. Another one is boosting-based, means you do a learning again. You can do supervised or unsupervised learning, but you do learning again. And then most of the learning is like add a boost, which is you look at the data, you learn. And if these data persistently getting errors, then giving this kind of data more weight, let's learn again. So try to reduce the error. Whether this is really good, this is just the today's state part. In this area, it requires a lot more innovation. And then from statisticians, from a computer scientists, okay? And that's why I said there's a lot of opportunity in research. Now, why ensemble works? Because we all know, you have a big elephant. You touch different parts of the elephant, you get a better picture if you combine, okay? So obviously, ensemble improves. If you use mathematical formula, you can see. You have five models. If everybody has 70% of accuracy, you just simple do a simple math. You know you're going to improve. So therefore, ensemble is really powerful. Now the difficulty is how do you choose the base model to learn? Okay, the five base models have to be completely independent. If they are predict the same result, they do the same learning, they don't come, they don't improve, they stay the same. You want to dramatically improve this, you need a good model. Okay, so this is a sequence problem. Okay, so then just forget this. So that's the first innovation. Second innovation I want to talk a little bit is on computing side. Okay, which is if I have healthcare data, what can I do to make the healthcare data analysis much more efficient, much higher quality, much more scalable to the large amount of data generated constantly from the healthcare domain, okay? So here, what I'm gonna talk a little bit is how do we ensemble from a computing point of view, okay? Basically, if you look at a opportunities, many problems, we publish so much, it's case by case we publish. If you look at the mathematical model, the principles of analysis, we are identical. Okay, for example, if you look at a discrete optimization problem, everybody is using greedy algorithm. Now, if everybody is using greedy algorithm, then if you take the data set as network data set, graph data set, then the way they apply greedy algorithm is identical. Now, what is the difference is the utility function. Is the optimization function different. So, if I have a network social influence analysis versus I have sensor placement, I will place sensor on the chair, and where I place that I have limited budget, I can have the highest accuracy for effectiveness. And I place sensor in the houses that I can sense energy saving spot. And I can place limited number of sensors, I can get the highest energy saving. Then I can build a smart house. Okay, these are same problem actually. So what the problem they have is really, you are looking at a network of important entities, and you're looking at where to place something on the network. So if I have a social network, I want to look at what people that I should invest in this particular product, give them freebies, so they will do very well fine. They will help my product go through the whole network. So I want to compute that social influence effect. Now give the sensors, I want to place in a grave, on a chair, or in a house, and so that I can actually using small number of sensors that I can sense the most critical point so that I can actually save energy or save my dollars to putting sensor on. So the massage chair will be cheaper. Okay, you know, Taiwan has one of the best massage chairs that actually has this kind of skills. Okay. So now what we do is we have, what we are looking at is we have a set of vertices in the graph. We want to find, we have a limited budget K, which is I can only afford a K sensor in that graph. Therefore, I want to find a subset in this graph, that a subset of vertices that gave me the highest a utility, okay? If I find that subset somewhere here without looking at the entire set, then I'm getting done with my optimal solution. That's the discrete optimization. Now, in reality, discrete optimization is NPR, because that's the mathematical proof, right? I'm not a math person, so I don't prove that, but you can find a lot of features of that. Now, greedy algorithm, everybody uses. What is greedy algorithm? Local greedy. So I take empty set, I do study on each vertex, compute their utility, and then do every two vertex, every three vertex, every four vertex, I just compute until k, and then I take the best one. That's greedy algorithm. And then greedy algorithm can actually do really well in prediction. And why? Because if you happen to have the utility function, that function is a monotonic, either increasing or decreasing, and it's submodular, means the more sensor you add, the less gain you get. The less sensor you get, the more gain you get. So if you have that property, theoretically they prove that you can have a very good approximation. Now, if we will combine computer science, statistician, mathematician, we find all these beautiful algorithms. Then what we can do is we can actually, I'm gonna pass this. This is what it means so if we can combine, basically we can solve these kind of problems by just using greedy optimization. For example, sensor. So in the past, when you do sensor, you have a grid here. Then you put every grid cells, you put a sensor in. Therefore, in order to produce a really good massage chair that can really be effective as a human hand, then you want to put a very dense sheet in there. That will cost a lot. Okay, that's why massage chair is expensive. People like massage. If you cannot afford a human massage, a labor fee, then too bad you don't have it. Now today, they're having a better quality massage chair, but still costs you about $2,000, $3,000. But it's way cheaper than past, it's $8,000, $10,000. Okay, in US, we buy massive shares. Most of them are produced by Taiwan and South Korea. Okay, and how do they make it cheaper? So one way is they put the sensor in the less places. They put the sensor in the smarter places. And they do a lab test. So basically, they use a similar greedy algorithm. So what they do is they say, okay, so I will place sensor not everywhere in the massive share, but I will try to look at how humans sit. How humans' weight on the chair would make them feel. And then I will try to reduce the cost. So before, the cost is $6,000 to put the sensor on. Glass material, everything, and your price goes up to $10,000. So now, I'm gonna only put a $10,000 massage chair and sensor on stage. Then I can drop the price a lot lower. But how much accuracy? I can still get very good accuracy. Okay, there are papers on this, okay? And then they say, okay, compare my smart sensor placement with random placement on the same number of sensors with uniform placement on the same set of sensors, might get a higher accuracy. So that is actually a very powerful result, right? So this is basically shows that greedy algorithm, greedy algorithm gave you a much more predictions. Possibility prediction. But if you do optimal greedy, you get the same accuracy, but you are a lot faster. Because naive greedy, you're still crunching the data step by step. We have to do subset on one, subset on two, subset on three, all the way subset on k. You're gonna do all the possible iteration, compare, find the best one. Before you finish top k, you're not finishing. So if you do a fast greedy, super fast. Now, if every paper, every domain, every problem, you do this, how many papers you generate? And you never had a good tool. So if computer scientists are looking at all these kind of problems, they're using discrete optimization algorithms that are using optimal greedy algorithms. And what we can do is we can actually try to build a MapReduce, build a Spark system that can handle the discrete optimization problems. So then, we can looking at what kind of data structure, what kind of computation structure that are so similar. Therefore, we could just write one programmable abstraction framework. Then we can actually have people, have the domain scientists give me the F function. As long as they prove their F function is submodular monotonic, then you can use my computing framework, A1. And I don't have to do things. And the scientist doesn't have to write code. All they have to give you is a math function. And that would be beautiful result, right? So So I don't have it all, okay? I cannot even convince myself to work on this, okay? But the question here is, these are the opportunities that for us, as computer scientists, as information technologists, to actually looking at these kind of problems, looking at more general purpose solutions. Because the world of big data, going to very specific, domain specific cases now. Therefore, we publish paper on each sub-problem and the optimization statistics, but we don't publish more. But that publication, that tool does not solve the real problem for the scientists. Because the scientists learn the whole thing, and you implement how many different kinds of algorithms you do. Okay, so how do we improve the utility of the algorithms? So the scientists only need to write that simple function for you. The entire system set up on a large cluster, it runs as many data as possible. It will work. Okay, so that is a beautiful thing. Okay, so that's kind of thing that requires computer scientists, statisticians, mathematicians to find all these kind of beautiful math theorems that actually has the standard generic features that we can actually use. And then we can actually prove on this. Okay? And if you have dedication, I'm sure this will work. Okay. Last one. So once we have the data, we need to deploy the data, deploy the analytic tools in the real field. So what are the innovation we need also here? So if you look at all the monitoring devices, the Fitbit is very hot in the US now, and they're looking at all kind of a fancy watch. From a very expensive manufacturer watch, they all putting Fitbit into that and to boost the industry. And they are going to get a lot more watch sold than before because of these digital size capabilities. Now with all this kind of data, IBM storage domain is looking at if in the future we have an internet of things flooding with data, how do we change the storage infrastructure, storage system, so that we can consume this? And of course, every domain is looking at this kind of data, looking at the attractiveness of this data, right? And if you look at the genomic research, Professor Chang also mentioned there's the power of the genomes in treatment, in saving lives. Now, this one I get from the same website. They are basically talking about today to the cost of per person per genome is getting really, really low. So therefore, one day, we probably, today, you still have to spend a few thousand dollars to do this, okay, within 3 months interval. But as time goes on, I think everybody can afford that. Maybe insurance company requires people to do this. Okay, now what we are hiding is, how much data we have? How much data we generate? And how do we do this? Okay? Now, what computing can do today with that? We don't have tools for this. Okay? So that's why they are really interested in having data, having people crunching these things, and prepare for the future of the possibilities. Okay? So next thing what I want to mention is quality and privacy. Privacy is something that requires a huge innovation. And the quality also requires huge innovation. And that requires dedicated researchers as well. So let's look at the privacy first. So if you look at the privacy, with our medical data being possible to be analyzed by different service sectors, based on different service tools, and by different hospitals, different doctor offices, labs, they will do a better job. But what are the privacies of individuals, right? So a lot of people say, okay, there is a lot of resistance in that, especially high-profile people, VIPs. But actually, what I'm looking at is how do they define what is privacy? Should be changed, okay? Today, what we're looking at is as long as the data is shared, you lose all the privacy you have, okay? Because data is the center for the privacy. But actually, what we really want to protect is how you use it. I post my data there for you to read. I did not allow you to do inference on that. Okay, so then you can read it. You shouldn't allow to do the analysis on that. So therefore, how do we put data into the storage media that can prevent certain things that they shouldn't be used for? And that actually is a new way of looking at privacy. But how to do that, I don't know. Okay, but the question, these three questions has been asked a lot. I was in different kind of privacy panel. They all ask this question. fun. At the end, I believe that we should define for data you publish and provide a utility that you want people to use and provide the utility you forbidden people to use. And then the technology should be able to enable that. And then we'll have a world of big data and privacy. Okay, but I don't know how to do that, okay? But that's innovation that I think eventually we should have. Rather than saying the more data you put out there, you will totally have gone privacy. Privacy is very important for innovation, for individualism, for creativity. Now we all need private rooms, private space, okay? So I think it's really what is the definition of privacy should be re-examined, and we should provide the tools if we have a better understanding of that, okay? Next thing is quality. So there's two big dark side of big data that people talk about. One is privacy, one is quality. But I think the quality is even more important. Okay, and then the Google flowchart, Professor Chang also used that because that's one of the best examples. Okay, so the Google flowchart is a very attractive analysis, and they open it and people access it. And interestingly, CDC also has their own way of collecting data. They're a smaller amount, they're higher quality. And so Google Flowchart actually find a lot of metrics by looking at a large number of searches, by looking at a huge number of data, and try to fit certain data points. They did a sample-based study, okay? They're kind of a supervised learning study. Now, in contrast, CDC, based on their Williams Mapper report from different laboratories in the US, and the data statistics on treating patients. So therefore, the result they plot is, as data increase, then Google starts overestimating consistently. And the CDC stays in a, and at this point, the CDC's data becomes reference because of baseline, that the ground truth. So what the report says is the big data does not always tell accurate results. Sometimes maybe overestimate, sometimes underestimate. And so what this learns is that there's a lot of other ugly examples I didn't use because I don't have statistics. This one we have statistics. Big data can hurt people too, okay? Business can make decisions on using big data and can cause graves, okay? So the goal here is we need experts. Therefore, big data should be used only as a powerful, alternative, new reference point that a doctor never had it in the college, in their experiences. Now, big data gave them another way of looking at the patient, looking at the treatment result, and making decisions. And they are going to learn how to use this big data to make a decision as a reference point. But big data should never replace doctors, should never replace experts. We still need this world, we need experts, we need experiences. Doesn't matter if it's a company CEO, doesn't matter if it's a professional researcher, we need them. Because their experiences and they can actually combine with big data and help a lot. Now it comes on, how do we help doctors to learn what kind of difference that they can trust more? Then we need to honestly provide the confidence of the data we use, the support the conclusion, the prediction we have, and provide a statistical and a human expert-based support and confidence on both. And that will help doctors. For example, if there's a certain patient treatment, you run the doctors, well, how many doctors with a higher rank expertise have that kind of conclusion versus just patient majority vote, right? So there are a lot of things that can actually help, and that is people need to be dedicated to quality. Big data quality analysis. And that will actually help change a lot. Even though this area is a small area, but very few people dedicate their research on that. And that's very important. So that's the end of my talk. Thank you.
我刚刚对你那个 page 2的 time series data， 那你们那个 time series data 有没有一些 专家的意见，例如说这些 time series 是哪个 tag 啊，还是往哪一个 pattern 啊？你们在真正的 data 在跑 time series 是，我刚刚看到是做 grouping 而已嘛？那有没有说有一些专家 expert 给他一个 tag 或 label， 有没有这样的研究或 research？ 谢谢。
好，谢谢。所以问题是，If we study time， 如果我们要做 time series data， 有没有做过一些 a patient based labeling and analysis？ In the Emory Hospital， I work with them， they don't have。 And the data they have， they don't give you names， they don't give you age， they don't give you the race and the background， so therefore really limited data we have。 What we can have is time series data， the amount of drugs they use， the doctor's notes conclusion on the treatmentand whether they die or they live. And that's what we have. Okay.
So the raw time series there is no any tag or label?
Yeah, so we don't have a label on that because there's no people's identity information at all. But even that data is very powerful. But the question here is, we don't have a seed fund for that.
Yeah.
So we need to write a grant, okay, to do that. And otherwise, we don't have a people who are dedicated to that.And this particular director in the ICU unit, he hired several programmers from computer science major. But those people just stay there for a couple of years or a couple of months, they find another job, they leave. You see, right? So there's no enough a dedication incentive for doing that. So that's what I see. That's why I ask, what are the success stories? I see the problems. I see the wish list from doctors, but I don't see enough infrastructure, ecosystem to encourage computer scientists to work on that. For example, if I look at the Georgia Tech's PhD graduate, all of them still want to work at Google, Facebook, IBM, HP. That's the best job they can get. And the people who go to health sectors are second class. So therefore, you don't see the brilliant, great researchers going to those sectors. And then the people going there, they said that there's such a growth opportunity. I have some people that I know, they went there, they said, I was promoted, I feel the value of myself, but still the programmers is less capable, less dedicated. So that's what I see that. And if you would be able to have that kind of the best tip into that sectors, probably the progress will be a lot more. Or we have better tools that you don't need the higher end people, you just need the tools, right? That would be beautiful, possibly.
好，非常谢谢。那个因为时间的关系，我们现在休息十分钟啊，在这个休息的时候，你们可以再问。Electrical and Computer Engineering Department 的系主任，那他是也是这个他们有一个 Informatics Institute 的这个 Director 啊，那那个徐教授他现在是一个讲座教授啊，然后他获得了很多的奖啊，包括那个国科会的 Career Award， 然后在学校里得到很多奖，包括这个 Teaching Excellence Award 啊，这很不容易啊，因为像一般会做 research 的不见得会教书啊，那徐教授他又会教书又这个研究做得很好啊，那他也很 actively 去这个参加这个会议啊，他这个要这个今年明年我们学校主办这个 Big MM 的这个 conference 啊，那徐教授也是这个这个重要的 organizer其中一个啊，他这个2017年他还要举行一个 H3 International Conference on Bioinformatics and Biomedical， 事实上这个会好像明年会在我们这边举行的。
两个啦。
哦，不同的是不是 ？OK。OK， 对，这个好，我们欢迎那个徐教授，他的题目在这边啊。
好，
谢谢那个陈教授的那个 introduction 啊，很感谢那个 Jeffrey 那个蔡校长的这个。那我事实上我在离这里不远啊，我的那个 I grew up like about 10 miles away from here. So like you know, it's just like coming home idea. Yeah. 所以我还是用英文讲哈，那个比较 less stressful. I like the way you say that. OK，那我1999年在普渡毕业哈，然后就到 Missouri 大学，so it's about 15 years ago. 那是最长的地方 I think. 那中间有一个机会可以到 Cornell 去，但是还是决定留在这个地方 build up some programs. 那我是 Informatics Institute Director. I'm going to use a little bit about time to introduce like a free advertisement based on like an agreement from like a President Taiwan. And my spare time, I chair the Electrical Computer Engineering Department. And I'm also a faculty of Computer Science Department. Okay, so but the title is Fast and Accurate Knowledge Discovery from Massive Biomedical Data Sources to Innovations in Informatics. I'm sorry about a long title here. The idea here is very simple. How we're going to make things faster and more accurate. Okay, and then how we're going to make the raw data like, you know, and convert that into actionable practice. Okay, for biologists, for clinicians here. So like, you know, that's pretty much the basic concept of my talk. Both like the previous keynote speakers, Professor Zhang and Professor Liu, are like, you know, great about talking about the region here. I'm going to fly a little bit closer to the ground. I would say 5,000 feet, like, you know. So I'm going to talk about what I have done, and then like in the past 15 years about like, you know, big data related research. Back then we don't call that big data; we just call that how to make it faster or more accurate. Okay, so so let me give a quick review about what's Informatics Institute here. The idea here is like, we have biomedical informatics department here. We have like, you know, medical university, and we also have like, you know, from MU. We have both 8 units in one campus here. So you can take a look at this satellite image here, like, you know, all the departments, all the research centers are supporting Informatics Institute. So this institute started in 2008, and I was fortunate enough to start with them, to build this program from zero, from scratch. So like, you know, from zero faculty, zero students, now we have 42 core faculty members from 17 departments and 7 colleges and schools. So my everyday life is like, you know, calling deans around, calling department chairs around, and calling program managers around, like, you know, to like, you know, put teams together for like, you know, many different informatics research projects. And this one is supporting a PhD program, pure PhD program. We don't have master degree program yet. PhD program in 3 areas. So I will go through that. Before that, let me introduce this individual. His name is Don Lindbergh. He was the director of National Library of Medicine, one of the NIH institutes. And he started at Missouri as a pathologist, in the pathology department chair. And back in 1968, 69. I think that was the year I was born. And he said, like, you know, everything should be electronically recorded. So it's a non-electronic medical record. So he started very early informatics training in at Missouri, and like, you know, we train students from computer science, from biochemistry, from like, you know, different departments here. And then in 2008, we started this PhD program for that. Okay, so we got 3 training areas. They are all transcribed with PhD here. One is bioinformatics, and we all know bioinformatics, like when we got sequence, structure, plants, because Missouri is a like, you know, agricultural state. So we got a lot of soybeans, a lot of like, you know, corns. So many of my project, I send computer science students to soybean fields. Really. And then they come back and then they analyze the data and then try to do genotype correlation. And then animal sciences, we are one of the 6 universities in the United States with all the like, you know, colleges, vet medicine, human medicine, nursing, engineering, other sciences, all those kinds of things. And we are famous in journalism. You are in the business for this one here. Okay, so that's the bioinformatics area here. And we are pushing for precision medicine, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. health informatics, like, you know, to work with EHR. Tiger Institute, many of you like working in EHR area, you will know like two major vendors. One is Cerner, one is Epic. Okay? And Cerner is like, you know, it's just right next door to us. The headquarters is in Kansas City, so we work closely with Cerner. And this Tiger Institute is like, you know, 5 years, $10 million like, you know, project between Cerner and University of Missouri to do innovation in informatics, in medical informatics. So all the ideas we can quickly implement it into electronic medical records, like, you know, through the different types of the workflow. And then we implement that and we try on that. If that works well, we are going to we deploy that through Cerner's network to all the country for that. So that is like a Tiger Institute. We also work with CMS, Center for Medical and Medicare Administration, whatever they call that, CMS. Just like, you know, just like national, like, you know, insurance, but like, you know, for those poor or those like, you know, beyond 65 years old for that year. And that's a $13 million project, like, you know, for life square project here. So we work with also with human computer interaction, nursing informatics, and autism and health here. The third area is we just added this area, geoinformatics. This one means like everything is geocoded. So how we're going to process the data through health bio, and then how to integrate those information together here. So funding project includes epigenetics, public health, intelligence. We also have some projects with intelligence agency, agriculture, ecology, environmental study here. And this one is one of the funding projects from NIH to look at like the flyways of influenza infection. Okay, so how, like, at which point here you sample some data here about outbreak here, how you're gonna trace back the route of the potential, like, you know, issues for the influenza, avian influenza, mostly. Okay, so we launched like, you know, three areas and very relevant to this workshop conference here is the first one is big data analytics. We launched this one in 2012 for this one here. So we look at like, you know, large scale biomedical data analytics in memory computing, cloud computing, GPU computing, and health data mining here. And it was so many, like, you know, faculty working in this area since 2012. And you can look at, like, you know, from GPU computing to this kind of more like in-memory Hadoop Spark. And I'm going to talk a little bit about, like, you know, those projects, more like, you know, technology component. Yeah. So the second one is precision medicine informatics here. And we're going to put a building, $120 million building. And then, like, you know, I'll make sure each floor we will have informatics component. Okay, and there will be 15 PIs to be hired, like, you know, from informatics for precision medicine informatics, and each PI will have some class to hire. So we are looking forward to this type of the new initiatives from the university to put together for this one here. So understand complex morphoproteomics to individualize care at this point here, and also like, you know, more like sequence based, like, you know, precision medicine here. And that's the new idea called theranostics. Whoever would like to invent a new term here, you just combine two terms together. Therapeutic and then also diagnostic here. So that's the very new concept. We are working with Roche and also, like, you know, our pathology department to look at, like, you know, how we're going to provide different types of the diagnosis by looking at this type of the, like, you know, biomarker proteins network. Okay. The third area is One Health Informatics here. Because we are so close to our, like, vet medicine. Our vet medicine get just right next door. When I say right next door, I got to walk about, like, you know, like 6 miles per day. Just from one side of campus to another side of campus for like those kind of meetings here. So we are working with VMDB. Okay, that's the vet medicine databases, like, you know, used to be hosted in Illinois. Now it's in Missouri, and with 26 vet hospitals, like teaching hospitals from the United States, to contribute data to this one here since 1968. And also with that, like, you know, VCA, NTEC, that's the largest, like, you know, vet lab type of the chain here. And each day, like, you know, they have more than 500,000, like, you know, lab results sent in for, like, you know, every single day for that. and that is a really good database for us to work on. Cerner is our partner for many years for that. We got an NIH National Center for Milton Mouse Resource and Research Center for this one. So there are so many topics for our students to work on, from animal model, and then to look at from cellular, from organ model, and then how we answer human questions. Yeah. So many papers published, I don't have the statistic about 2,000 papers, many papers published through this VMDB and how to use the VMDB to link with that and link with human type of the healthcare related questions for that. So that's the third initiative here. So that's the whole idea about our campus trying to work together with this very basic implementation about data warehouse, and then with the inference model here, you can look at time series data, you can look at networking data and structured data, and also integration model here. Okay, and then that's the dashboard module. This one is already launched to our healthcare system. So our physicians at point of care, they can really see those dashboards about the patients, activities. Yeah. But again, very primitive. Okay, one dimension, two dimension, those type of data. Yeah. So not not exploratory enough at this point. Yeah. But at the same time, you got to give them some clean information. So otherwise, they are not going to take it. If there's so many beeps, they have beeping fatigue about that. So they are going to look at more beeps for that. So how are we going to provide this type of clean information for that? So that's our entire roadmap for biomedical big data and knowledge base idea for that. Okay, so it wouldn't be possible previously if we don't have big data type of the technology here. So how many of you have heard about Hadoop, right? You heard about Hadoop. How many of you are from computer science? Okay, how about biomedical engineer, informatics? Okay, So Hadoop actually, you know who is the founder of Hadoop, inventor? Douglas Cuddy. Okay, Douglas Cuddy is the co-inventor. He's very polite, not modest. He said, I'm co-inventor. But actually, he's the major player for this one here. Hadoop is a toy of his son. So when they try to name the system, they say, that's Hadoop. Yeah. So there's no meaning at all about the technology. Okay, so that's the real Hadoop, and that's the Hadoop you see from the website here. Or so do I really know big data here? I would say, I stand here and talk about things I don't know. Okay, do I really know big data? I use that. I develop new algorithms for big data. But you ask me, am I an expert? I would say, I'm still learning. Okay, none of us, whose age here, we are trained with big data here. We learn on the fly for big data. So for those young individuals here, it's the right time for you to catch the big data wave here. So we put together this kind of sandbox. That was back in 2011, I believe. We put together this sandbox to start with this type of the idea here. And then now we got Spark, we got Solar here. Have you seen about this word here, YOTA? Yotabyte, okay. Yotabyte is the largest number ISO can really recognize at this point. I know, Dr. John show Bronobyte. Okay. So yotabyte is 10 to 24. 10 to 24. That's big enough, right? So that's my license plate. So if you are in the United States, you see my license plate, say hello to me. So that's a big data landscape here. That big data landscape here, you can look at, that was back in 2012 here, right? You got so many big data activities here. Okay, so I'm gonna show you some. This picture is a year later. 1.5 years later, from this one here, you see a lot of startup companies, a lot of technologies developed for that here. You only see 2015? That's 2015. Okay, so where are we here? I don't know, for me, I can point some places, I use some technology here, I develop algorithms, very similar to what industry is doing here. So how we're going to place ourselves to the right position to compete, right? Are we able to compete with those kind of startup companies? They are showing some promising tools out there here. So how are we going to do that? As a research institution here, how are we going to do that here? We keep asking ourselves every day. We keep sending our postdoc students to those meetings and bring back some new ideas
how to do this again, the technology of yesterday. Okay, so they came back from San Francisco like early this year and said, look, we are doing everything is in memory computing now. So what is our position for big data here? Okay, so I'm not going to talk about all those tools here because I have no idea about what are those tools here. But like, you know, we got some like experience about big data back in like, you know, 15 years ago. So let's take a look at, for those of you, how many of you have like those kind of painful experience whenever you receive your grant proposal review and also your paper, okay, we got chief editor here, so. About like, you know, big data approach here. So about 10 years ago, I got this kind of review back here. This was a $3.5 million grant from NSF, okay? And then I got in NSF, for those of you submitted proposal to NSF, you got two excellence, and then one good or very good, you should get a funding, okay? I got two excellence and one poor. And that's the individual gave me this poor here, okay? So the individual say, I don't think the proposed research is relevant since biology combined to wait for 40 days to get a present results from computers. It's not valuable to have 1200 speed up. I don't care about 1200 speed up here, okay? By sacrificing 3% of the accuracy. That was the mentality, like, you know, back in like, you know, it was 10 years ago. Okay, 5 years ago, biologists do not really trust computational methods that provide speedy search without rigorous benchwork to validate the results obtained from the output. Okay, that's the reviewer's comment. So this paper was started with Science, got rejected. Nature got rejected. Nature Communication got rejected. We sent to PNAS, finally got accepted. Okay, so that's the painful process about this type of stuff. And thanks to like the White House big data initiatives, now we start getting this kind of good feedback about, hey, that is a cool idea. That can streamline your process here. And say, yes, that's the time goal to get more money. Okay, so I'm gonna talk about four types of the research I have been doing. So it's more like, you know, my research. I'm sorry I don't give like, you know, big vision here, but I'm going to talk about my research. I'm hoping like, you know, for faculty here, and then we can look at what can we do together, okay, in the future for this one here. The first one is protein structure and functions here. So back then we started with like, you know, some certain type of the structure and analytics work and the search engine, and from global structure all the way to small tiny binding site type of the interaction type of the work here. So computational challenge is like, you know, it's 3D. And it's dynamic, just like this protein structure here. You got iron here, and it's going to change the fold. Protein structure is not rigid. It's not like, you know, all the data files we access from PDB database. It's so dynamic here. Okay, and this one has something to do with anemia, like, you know, like iron deficiency type of thing. So by understanding the function of this one, it's going to really help us to move forward for many, like to answer many medical questions for that. So that's the computational challenge, okay? So if you look at like, you know, number of protein structures since 1993 to 2015, as of today here, and you can see like, you know, protein structure all jumping all the way up to this point here, okay? And for those reviewers gave us the feedback, that was the point when they say, yeah, I don't like to sacrifice like 3% of the accuracy. And then if they have known like, you know, you are going to grow to this point here, and then no matter what kind of Moore's law you have, number of transistors you have here, you are still suffering from that, okay? And then this point here. So you see like, you know, everything like growing like this way here. If we do exploratory analysis, that means pairwise analysis. If I really want to understand the full picture of the protein universe here, you have to have like about 6.5 billion comparisons, structure comparisons. Okay? And then as of December 5th, 2015, we have about 308,000 protein chains in the database. So how to quickly retrieve like similar chains, or how to quickly try to find like, you know, binding sites from those chains? That's a challenge. That's the computational challenge here. Okay? So if you look at SCOP is like, you know, between human and automatic type of the like, you know, curation. To talk about like talking the protein domain, protein fold, and has something to do with the function idea here. You can look at like, you know, back then the blue part is like, you know, the gap between the overall number of proteins and then this one is like the protein was annotations. So you can see like the scope gap up at some certain point. You pass that to Burgers group, and Burgers group try hard to catch that, you really, really try hard, really. You need to have human to sit there and run some consensus type of the algorithms and try to find like, you know, the annotation of the fault or like domains for that. You can see the gap is still huge here. It's still huge here. So how are we going to shrink the gap here? So that's the like, you know, structured bioinformatics system developed roadmap in my lab. Okay, so back in 2003, my great colleague Dong Xu, like, you know, came from like, you know, Oak Ridge National Lab. And then he came here and he said, you know what? I think your technology to do image search can help like, you know, structured bioinformatics. So if I do something really lousy, that's all his fault. To bring me to like the bioinformatics area here. Okay. I really appreciate like, you know, his input about that. So we started with ProteinDBS, like, you know, how we're going to use the global 3D structure and then to retrieve similar global 3D structure. That was the simple question like we tried to answer here. And then we used about 3 months to do feature extraction, indexing, and then do things by using my previous work here. And we published this one here. Okay? And then later we said, okay, so in addition to protein structure here, am I able to get some more functional information from that here? So we use the global structure for scope classification. And then we think about like, so we got like, you know, some inputs from like Eli Lilly, from those from Sluga coming and saying, look, it's kind of useful for us, but like if you can do substructure search, that can help us much more. So we started with like, you know, substructure search, and that's it's an MP issue here. Okay, whenever you do substructure mesh, for those of you computer scientists, it's MP issue here. So 2009 here, we decided, okay, let's use the substructure and do scope classification, do we get better results? Okay, and then in early 2010, we got like GPU technology coming up. Okay, so how are we going to use GPU technology to help us do better speed up at the 9MP. And then, like, you know, between 2013, 14, and 15 here, we developed protein binding sites analysis. So I'm going to quickly fly through this roadmap and also show you like what type of the technology we use for to make things faster and more accurate. So the protein structure, real-time global protein structure retrieval here was 308,000 structures. If you submit a structure in a database, I'm going to give you results in seconds. Okay, so it's very challenging, and if you have done like image search, you will say, ah, FT sub K. Okay, so you look at that here, structure here, how we map the structure into distance matrix here. Darker means these two amino axes are closer. Lighter means they are far away. Okay, so a structure could have 300 amino axes, could have 1300 amino axes here. So how we're going to map this one into a 2D structure, and how we're going to use computer vision algorithms to do like, you know, extraction of meaningful patterns, and then how we're going to use indexing structure through different distributed computing idea to get better, like, you know, faster results here. Okay, so we build this one here, and that's the like, you know, tree structure search here. This structure combines both machine learning and also database indexing idea for this one here. It's called entropy balance statistical KD tree here. So I'm going through the like, you know, formula here. And at this point here, like, you know, BigMM, like, you know, we have a student done about the paper here now for this one here, is how we're going to use distributed indexing using Spark in memory environment here. So when we have all those type of the indexes here, how we're going to quickly search that? We simulate the data to 100 million structures, are we able to get the results in real time? Okay, so that is our goal here. Is that real time enough or pseudo real time? I can wait a couple minutes to get that. I think it should be fine too. So, like, you know, the research here is like how we're going to, like, you know, do some sort of scheduling idea and also searching and then aggregation of the searching for this one here. So this one will be submitted to BigMM next year here. So for the one CPU, not one CPU, one small cluster, CPU-based cluster, the retrieval accuracy is between, like, you know, like high 80s to 90, 97. When you increase your recall rate, it drops to about 80, 5. And then, like, you know, with 10% recall rate, it's about 95 to 97. That's the global structure search here. And then the, like, you know, efficiency here, you can see, like, you know, from, like, you know, 0.51 seconds all the way to about 3.5 seconds. Okay, so really, like, you know, that really can handle big data. So this one was the first real-time search engine. I can claim this one, it was published earlier than everybody here. So this one here was featured in Science magazine about protein matchmaking for this work. Okay? And then we published at, like, you know, NAR back in 2004 for this one here. Now, like, you know, we move on, because, like, you know, once we are able to search, how we are going to find, like, you know, the function, meaning of those structures here. So, like, you know, we use, like, you know, this type of the classification and identification of protein folds here. The experiment here is, like, you know, you pull out one version and the version after that here. And we try to see the new proteins. Are we able to classify them to existing protein folds? Or we can say that's a novel fold here. And that's pretty much, like, you know, the community is looking for this one here. So you have this one here, very similar stuff here. And then indexing that and do e-predict, you got non-fold or non-fold here. So there's a result here. The accuracy is really high at this point here for existing fold here. And the time here is, like, you know, for our process is like 6.34 seconds to get that. That's an old machine. And then CE, like, you know, that's the leading, like, you know, leading methodology here, costs about 4.3 hours to do that. Okay, so you can see the difference here because of the speed, we have the luxury to do more. Okay, that's very important. And then that's classification accuracy, like, you know, efficiency. You can see, like, you know, I call this one pseudo real time. It's not really getting a result right away. It's, like, you know, between 10 to 20 seconds for this type of the large, like, protein chain size. Okay, so now we know global structure. We know, like, you know, fault from global structure here. Are we able to find, like, a substructure retrieval, substructure search here? You can look at this one here. That's the structure here, that's substructure here. So for substructure here, it's very computational challenging. Okay, you have no idea which one will match with which part here. And that has some functional information inside the substructure here. So to do this one here, like, you know, we use the information retrieval ideas with the spatial information and index all those kind of substructure variations in the database. And how many leaf nodes here? About 2.4 million leaf nodes there, because there are so many variations. And then for those very similar structures, we group them together for that here. So for this one here, our efficiency is this way here. That's our approach, that's the time, response time here. That's the, like, you know, the fastest, like, you know, approach, existing approach. That is the lowest approach for the highest accuracy here. So you can see, like, an, you know, improvement over those here, okay? The accuracy here is really high here, 90%, and then DALI, this one has really high, 89.33. So speed up is good, and we can also, like, you know, outperform the majority of the DALI. Some folks, we totally cannot compete with DALI at all for that. But this one here is, like, you know, slightly better for that. But comparing to the, like, you know, fastest, like, approach CE, like, you know, we are about, like, you know, 8.67%, like, better for this one. So this one gives us the, like, you know, the hope to move up. Okay, so we built this one here, and this one was published in Bioinformatics in 2009 about scope for classification retrieval index space for this one. Okay, so, and then, like, you know, we look at the GPU market here, and GPU, like, you know, started with those type of the GPU number of cores here, and up to this point here, GTX Titan has this kind of number of cores here. Early this year, NVIDIA announced, like, you know, they have a GPU card under $1,000, okay, have more than 5,000 cores inside that. So you can really buy, like, you know, those, like, inexpensive. You put two cards in your server, you have 10,000 cores of a GPU computing power for that, okay? And then you look at the clock rate for, like, an Intel still staying here. So how we're going to deal with like multi-core and more cores here? How to work on a small texture memory, slower core, but how we're going to utilize like this kind of massive computing power for those kind of small cores. And that's the key here. And it is like a painful experience because the CUDA back then was hard to code. How many of you coded CUDA before? CUDA? No? Okay, so that's a GPU like the programming language like from NVIDIA. It's very painful to do that here. Okay, so like so we build this one here, parallel protein structure alignment tool for this one here. And with those kind of offline, online, and how we partition the work into small texture memory, 3 gigabyte back then here. And now like the new car has more than 10 gigabyte here. But still like the luxury is we don't have much luxury about memory in the GPU computing. So with this one here, we compare with different approaches. Okay, with TM-Align, we got 35.9% speed up. And then for different data set, we have different speed ups for this one here. So you look at this way here, it's like GPU computing might be a way to go. Okay, in addition to Hadoop, Spark, distributed computing. Okay, now, I think that's the very next thing I'm going to talk about. PBS work here, protein binding site comparison here. Now, once we know how to do substructure, are we able to find binding sites? Are we able to do those type of information? And how are we going to use the service information, physical, biological, and information to do this kind of search? Okay? So with that here, you can see we use different data set to compare with different approaches here. And this one tells us that this one 0.76 versus different approach here. And then at top 10 results, I-Align has 100% accuracy, we have 92% accuracy here. Okay? And still cannot compete with I-Align. But it is extremely slow for I-Align for that. Okay? And then for top 10 results, we can really be up to 95% accuracy for different data sets for that. Okay? So we are going to sacrifice accuracy, that's no doubt, if we want to do this type of the big data approach here. But is that bearable? Okay, just like the previous talk about the cost of the smart chair is going to reduce from that much to reduce to $100 here. You just sacrifice a little bit. Are we okay with that? So this one it was published in Bioinformatics in 2012 and Nuclear X Research on this one here. Okay? So one more here. So we we figured out the bottleneck is for why it's pseudo real time. It's because of alignment here. Alignment is very time consuming here. So how are we going to use better idea to align the proteins well for this one here? So we developed this one here, and then we compare with, again, I-Align and with different approaches with the different scoring about how good are those alignment here. We published in, what is that? TCBIB, right? Yeah. Okay, so the next topic is is computational morphoproteomics idea. And this one, for physicians, clinicians, how many of you clinicians? We got Professor Zhang. Okay. So this one here is new ideas from our pathology department to look at how to do diagnosis differently. Okay. And then because we push for digital pathology in many years, we have all those type of the IHC type of the images, and how we're going to use that information to get better idea about chemotherapy, if chemotherapy does not the patient is not responding well for chemotherapy, if we put different drugs there, will there be effective results? Pretty much simple question to answer for this one. So that's the idea about theranostics idea in our institution. So this morphoproteomics study from Dr. Brown, Robert Brown from UT Healthcare System, he started with this area here called morphoproteomics area here. So the idea here is like, you know, how we're going to use this type of the slides, IHG slides, and then go to this type of the network, and then provide better care. Yeah. And physicians or pathologists have really no whole map of the idea about which one or in the network is which one. Biomarkers versus biological pathway is very tough. It is very tough. So how we're going to quickly find those potential interactions and then show that and then link with the FDA database about different pharmaceutical type of information to provide like, you know, a point of the care type of the recommendation from that. Okay? So that's the approach we use to RDF network. I think there are so many experts here doing RDF network idea here, and that's a really big data issue here. With all those biological pathways, like, you know, any server can run for days and weeks just try to get those information out here. So how are we going to parallelize that? How are we going to use big data technology to better, like, you know, understand those interaction network? Okay, so I'm going to quickly go through, like, you know, those types of the. This one is a patient, like, you know, does not respond well for chemotherapy and was acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And then, like, you know, we use this one and then try to understand, like, you know, what happened if we have those potential drugs with those potential proteins inside that, would the patient like respond well for this one? Okay, so we run the tools we built here and then we come up with, like, you know, some recommendations for that here. Okay, and this is still ongoing work here, and the outcome we still don't know yet, but we are able to pull out those type of the potential treatment for that. And then the next one here is more like, you know, discovering new morpho-proteomics findings here. Like, you know, from literature, they may not giving us enough, they might give us enough, like, information to do that. In this case here, we found some new biomarkers and new potential treatment for patients. And by reading the literature, like, you know, from our pathology collaborators here, we see, like, you know, we see those relevant significance of those new interactions. Published this paper at Journal of Biomedical Informatics in 2014. Okay, so the third one, I think I'm running out of time here. Okay, I don't want to talk more, like, you know, you have lunch waiting for you. Genomic sequence pattern mining here. Okay, so it's very important for those of you using, like, DNA data, mRNA data, mRNA data, or a SNP data set here. Like, how we're going to find interesting patterns out of the database. So I'm going to use one example, very simple example. Like, when we started with trying to find ultra conserved patterns of the sequences across different genomes, across different domains. And then you can look at, like, you know, cat, chicken, chimpanzee, all the way here, how many billion of base pairs we get to deal with. Okay? So Dr. Zhang said, like, you know, hey, we got new sequence information here. How are we able to really handle those kind of scale here? So we first started with so-called ultra-conserved elements here. So ultra-conserved elements, like, you know, you got some sequence, complex sequence here, have been conserved by different species over hundreds of millions of years, okay? So what does that mean here? Through evolution, they never been changed. There got to be some reason related to this one here. So cellular functions and transcriptional regulation here. And this has been published at Science and Nature back in 2004-2006 here. And then we use this one here, and one of my PhD students, like, you know, Jeff Reniker, started with this project here, and then, like, you know, worked with animal sciences and also plant sciences, and also a couple of folks from Berkeley and Arizona. And Michael Freeling is, like, you know, is an academy member at Berkeley. So we worked together for this one here. And this is, like, you know, published in PNS for long identical multi-species elements in plant and animal genomes here. So we started with this work here, and we look at tandem repeats. Tandem repeats are very important for us to, particularly when we do metagenomics type of the work here. You got so many different, like, you know, different genomes in different chunks here, and how we're going to find which one close to what type of the genome. Okay, so, like, you know, we work on this one here, and this one's been published in two different places. And then the third one is a very interesting pattern. It's called pattern memories. Canyon Jones. So what does that mean here? If you read this one here, a man, a plan, a canon, and a Panama here. You read that back here, a man, a plan, a canon, Panama. Okay? It's called Canyon. And Canyon, like, you know, in DNA sequences, is very important. Okay, it's very important here. Has so many diseases related to that. Okay? So if you look at that here, like, you know, what does that mean here? It's sequence here. If you read through from here to here, and you take a complement of this sequence, and you read through from here to here, that's the same. Okay? That creates some sort of, like, you know, some sort of complex secondary structure with, like, you know, loop structure, so bacteria, virus are able to bind, get into that, chop it, and then get some, create some potential molecular interactions. So very small pattern here, computer scientists or informaticians can do to identify those, like, you know, patterns. And that's one of the patterns from mouse, like, you know, with this kind of complex patterns. Okay? So you have time, you can go through this way, complement here, they are identical, like this way. So with this one here, we try to answer human health question here. CRISPR structure. And many of you doing clinical research, you will say, like, it's a hot topic now. Okay? You go to Nature, there are a lot of CRISPR structure understanding for this one here. So CRISPR structure is a mixture of the idea of repeats and also this kind of penetronic structure here. So how to deal with that here and how to make it happen with that kind of large scale change? You cannot use alignment algorithm to do that here. There's no way. Okay? Because it's not going to work well. Was not even giving you comprehensive results for that here. So how are we going to do that here? Okay? So I have a student working for a BIDE paper here. So hopefully, like, hope you accept it, right? So sequence pattern mining architecture here using big data ecosystem here. So like, you know, we will be able to handle all the genomes from ensemble database. Okay? All the genomes. In a 10 node, each one has 22 cores, 128 gigabyte memory, this type of the, like, you know, distributed computing idea here, to handle all of them here. So we use this type of the big data ecosystem to work on that and then to really, like, you know, mine the patterns of that. So those are patterns, like, discovered by like, a biologist, by several individuals. But is that only that? CRISPR structure, can we find something more complex? And then when we link with the healthcare data, is that going to give us more insight about, like, you know, about human healthcare? Okay, so I'm going to fly through this one here, electronic medical records here. We work with Cerner. Cerner has health specs data with 50 million individual patients. 50 million, and it's the identified data. Okay, so what we can really do is to do some sort of cross-country study. Cerner's data is from 90 like, you know, institutions across US for that here. So how are we going to study that and then look at our, like, you know, Taiwanese, like, you know, national insurance data to look at what could be potential difference. Okay? And then I'm sure we can publish many, many papers out. So that's the idea here, and the idea is, like, you know, how we do contrast mining more exploratory. At this point here, most of the medical research more like the hypothesis treatment. Okay, so you agree with me or not? It's more like, you know, I suspect this one here. I suspect these two populations. Let's try to pull out data and try to do statistical analysis of that. Pretty much about that here. But is that it? Okay, even you look at, like, you know, time series analysis here. If we aggregate all the patients together here, we may not be able to find any patterns out of that. But if we separate them with different sub-diseases, with different types of the, like, even demographic backgrounds, we might be able to find something interesting. So that's one of our, like, ongoing research. Actually, like, there's a proposal to be submitted in February for an NIH-R1 proposal. Like, how are we going to do, like, the population, like, exploratory analysis of this one? So we don't want to know any hypothesis here. How are we going to let it automatically run? And let it automatically extract those kind of the high contrast across different populations. Okay? So by using using like again like this kind of distributed computing idea, pattern contrast mining, and also gross rate support difference for this one here. And one of my students working with this type of the Cartesian schedule for distributed absorption rule mining idea, and then how to utilize this kind of in-memory computing idea to quickly compare information together. This other review for a conference paper here. So an example of actionable insight here. This one was published in Nursing Research. So I'm also a nursing faculty. And that's true. I'm also an Asia faculty from the School of Nursing here. So we work with the international lymphedema network, with how many countries? I would say more than 15 countries. We collected data from many countries. It's an NIH-funded project. So we collected data from many places and tried to study different intervention methods and also different countries' insurance policies and try to see why the management of the care could be different from different countries. And there are so many interesting findings. And then this one is for example, is this one here. We try to measure the lead volume, with mobile device too. And then over many visits, and each one, T1 to T9 could be 3 years apart for that year. And at some certain point, the patient is diagnosed with lymphedema. That means it's irreversible disease. Once you have diagnosis of that year, you are not bad for that. So we try to prevent that from happening or try to prolong or postpone the diagnosis for this one here. So how we use this type of the temporal mining idea to find that here. This model also at this point we are also trying to work on intervention in between, because time series analysis has never been as smooth as this way here. You might have different interventions, different surgery, different interventions, and how we change the model. Okay, so how we can provide this predictive type of analytics for patients, for physician therapist, for this type of work here. So the goal is to have this kind of dynamic finding, and then with this best practice and management for this one, electronically. So it's evidence-based from different countries, from different regions. If you are Caucasian, if you are an Asian, what could be different? So very personalized, view. So here's my conclusion, if you're hungry. Yeah. Okay, innovations in computing from information retrieval, multimedia database, big data analytics will provide structured biologists, geneticists, and clinicians new avenue at a much bigger scale than those we have done previously, smaller scale here. Okay, and the goal is to have faster and more accurate computing methods. Okay? And then also knowledge exploratory and discovery is no longer hypothesis driven. And then how we connect dots here. The research I'm doing now, still not connecting dots. Some dots, but still not connecting dots across genome, proteome, phenome, and to have actionable claim for this one here. Okay? And then I'm going to have this one for panel discussion about what's the challenge for us to move forward as a biomedical informatics. Okay, acknowledgement here. I got I got my great group here. They look so cute here. Yeah. Really, they are really good helpers. And then all my colleagues here, and then funding by mainly NSF and NIH, and some of the endowment for biomedical informatics here. Thank you.
时间有点迟，不过我想还是 take one question 好，这个。
教授，很精彩的演讲，其实蛮详细的。我想了解一下那个 scope 和那个 classification， 那个 fold 它是因为它在 scope 里面有分 alpha、 beta、 alpha plus， 就是它那个 scope 的 fold 的话，它有分 alpha、 beta， 还有 alpha plus beta、 alpha slash beta， 还有些是，但它是个 multi class 的一个 classification， 那你来。 iPSC 可以达到90%的 accuracy， 我想知道你哪个是用哪个有几种的 class 的。
Okay， so if I hit one， I will say that is good。 Okay， so if I hit one， 如果它是有 multiple classes， for 这个东西的话, if I hit one and another one was the second highest, I would say that that's good. Okay, so if you have three or four, we don't consider. We consider the best one and the second best one.
So,
it's a lot of things. Yeah, but it's not classified as secondary structure. It's the domain, even the domain of like, you know, the protein like chain. Yeah. Okay, so it's not just alpha and beta, alpha and plus beta. But we go even deeper. Even deeper. Okay, yeah.
好，那我们再一次谢谢我们今天三位 speakers， 然后也谢谢大家的